Okay, we'll call this meeting to order. This is the September 8th meeting of the Yellow Springs Village Council. Judy, would you please call the roll?
Yes. Wintrow?
Here.
Lori Asplund is going to be in a little bit later this evening. She had a prayer commitment. Sims?
Here.
Hausch?
Yes.
McQueen?
Yes.
Also present is Village Manager Patty Bates, Assistant Village Manager-to-be Melissa Van Zant, and Chief Hale is also present.
And our solicitor will be arriving late, is my understanding?
Yes.
So the next item on the agenda is always a nice one, swearing in of a, not a new employee, but a new position, an employee in a new position. I will turn that over to Patty to do the swearing in of her Assistant Village Manager, Melissa Van Zant.
Okay, before we step down, I would just like to say a couple words about Melissa. A lot of you know her already. She's been a village employee for about a year and a half, almost 2 years now. She does an incredible job as a finance manager, and I just can't say enough about how happy I am that she applied for and then accepted the AVM position, and I am exceptionally proud to be swearing Melissa in tonight. So we need to get down there.
Have your cheat sheet.
Never done this before.
When I brought the whole sheet, I thought you'd get yours, so I'm gonna bring the whole. So if you would raise your right hand and then repeat after me. I solemnly swear or affirm.
I solemnly swear or affirm.
That I will support the Constitution.
That I will support the Constitution.
And will obey the laws of the United States.
And will obey the laws of the United States.
And of the state of Ohio.
And of the state of Ohio.
That I will, in all respects.
That I will, in all respects.
Observe the provisions of the Charter.
Observe the provisions of the Charter.
And ordinances of the Village of Yellow Springs.
And ordinances of the Village of Yellow Springs.
And will faithfully discharge the duties.
And will faithfully discharge the duties.
Of the Office of Assistant Village Manager.
Of the Office of Assistant Village Manager.
That's always exciting and fun. Thank you. Next item on the agenda is announcements. We will start off with our State Representative, Rick Perales, who had asked to come and give us an update on what's happening in Columbus.
Thank you. And I want to thank the Village Council for having me here. I try to get around to my district. I work for you folks. I never want anyone to forget that. I'm there for you folks. And if there's an issue you need to talk to me about, specifically, you got my phone number. I can come talk to you. But this was initiated by me. I'd like to just get around. I don't have a lot of time, and I got some slides, so I'll try to get through them as quickly as possible. And then I'd offer up, if you want to, you got my cards, if you want to ask me questions, or anyone in the audience wants to ask me questions on the last slide, we'll have my contact information and information to get a copy of these slides. So anyone can get them, they can contact me, my aide, and we can have some dialogue as necessary. Is it all right to start?
Great, go.
Thank you. Okay, I'm taking time off of this. Is there a screen I put it on?
Just the right arrow, just to the right of your 1 through 11.
Right here?
Bottom. Go a little more,
One more.
There you go.
Oh, I was looking for the full picture. That's all right.
Oh, sorry.
Okay. Okay, a little bit about myself, and I this is my first time meeting some of you, and you have the slides, so you can look at that, where I got my degree from, and some of my background, what I've served in the past for the district, including the United States Air Force, where I served a career as a civil engineer in the Air Force. This talks a little bit about my history, some awards. I was just awarded the Wick Wright Award for aerospace contributions by the Aviation Heritage Hall of Fame, which was a nice honor. And then my committees, which are very important, so people can see that. I have highlighted there the Finance Higher Education Subcommittee, because it's the first time on Finance, and it's an honor to be on Finance. It takes a lot of work, but you learn everything. Everyone testifies before the budget is approved. So you see everyone that's getting state money, and you understand their mission a little bit better. And that was very helpful for me. Current legislation I have pending Real quickly, House current resolution number 8, that is, there's a debate on who was first in flight with Connecticut. It's just affirming, along with North Carolina. And I say it's the first time North Carolina and the state of Ohio has ever agreed on anything related to flight. So that's kind of interesting. But it's important for our students to know where flight started. And this will help with that. House Bill 32, right now, ODOT collects aviation fuel, and they collect about $14-15 million a year. They put $700,000 back in the airports, which is crazy. Our airports are deteriorating just as much as our roads, and so this bill is getting more of that money to put in the airports, including the Greene County Airport. I got $6 million this year, $6 million next year, and I'm going to try to get that closer to all $14 million that comes in. You know, if it comes in by aviation fuel, it should be used for aviation purposes. And please feel free to interrupt me when you want.
So what's going to replace the roads money, the money that would have gone to the roads? Where is that going to come from?
I don't know.
Because we're already in trouble.
But we're in trouble in both, and you can't do one without the other. So I didn't get any of the roads money. I didn't even get all of the aircraft money. I'm just getting a small portion because they only put $700K in it last year. So we got to do better. We got roads, fences, of course, runways, rampways. So that's that one. 105 is just helping the military spouses when they PCS because they have to quit their job. 44 other states give some form of unemployment to the spouses. I want Ohio to be one. We got to keep being friendly to the veterans. They bring a lot to the table. 192, State Board of Education. These are some safety enhancements, like a panic button that I'm going to require to be put in during construction. That's the time to do it, not after the fact. That's when it's expensive. It's not real expensive to design it and do it when it's in the construction design phase. So there's like 4 or 5, and I can give you the provisions that we have, lockdown type of provisions, video cameras, that kind of stuff that makes common sense in case there's an incident at a school. 222, I don't know if you know much about it, but bus drivers and the public transit are getting attacked, and it puts a lot of innocent people in danger, the people on the bus and the people that the bus driver is driving. And so all I'm doing in this one is making the penalties commensurate with what we do for school bus drivers. And so that increases a little bit, but it gives some coverage because, you know, on public transit, there's no separation. I mean, anyone can go up there and do whatever they want, and they have. And there's cases I can show you if you're interested. House Bill 306 is an egress bill that when I was the director of facilities at the University of Dayton, we had a kid on a third floor of an old building, a stick building we call it, burn up, and he couldn't get out. It was right, actually, he was a football player. It was right before they were going to pick him up and take him to his brother's game because he was playing in the Super Bowl. It was a sad, sad story. He couldn't get out. He got disoriented. There was no egress. This is simply going to ask the landlords to put ladders or some kind of way to get out besides a center stairwell, which they can't get out when the smoke's there.
So this isn't – so existing properties aren't grandfathered in? This
no,
is
oh, absolutely
all
not.
Existing.
Yes, yes.
Wow, that's going to have a huge impact.
We're working with all those folks, but really a rope ladder costs about $300. So there's some simple ways. We're not trying to, we're just trying to make it safer. You know, when parents send their kids to school, they expect the schools to take care of them and be safe. Even though this is private property, like at UD, we have 300 or 400 properties out there that, you know, we still got to take care of. So we're trying to minimize it, and we're coordinating with the property owners on that. Budget amendments. These are the budgets I put in. I got $20 million for the Applied Research Corporation at Wright State, and this is where they are working to collaborate with the aerospace, the industry throughout the state for work training and for bringing in talent so that they can better win. There's like $50 billion of contracts between NASA and Wright Labs that we're getting a very small portion. This is, and we've already got benefits on that. We've got 500 jobs from that one already from last 2 years. We've got money, we've got contracts, so it's working. And other states are doing this, so we've learned from other states. We're taking the best of that. I have no problem with copying if it works. The second one, their federal research, is doing the same thing, but we're bringing in all the universities. So NASA Glenn, Wright-Patterson Air Force Base with Ohio State, Wright State, UD, Toledo, all the universities collaborating, figuring out what we do best, and putting all the right minds. We've never done that before. It sounds like it's pretty simple, but we've never done it before. I got $5 million in the budget for what we call BRAC, to help do things that may make it less attractive to close the base down, to close any federal installation down, including NASA Glenn, because that's going to hit us again. It'll probably be 16. We're going to have another BRAC round. That's a base realignment and closure, reducing the infrastructure because of cost, which we need to do. Yes, ma'am.
I have a question about that. If we really don't need a military facility, why put things in place to make it more difficult to close?
Excellent question. And the key is that the mission is always first. So I was a commander at Wright-Patt, so I understand what they do and how they do it. The fact is Wright-Patt will never close. But they are going to be subject to either gaining missions or losing missions, which equates to economic development and jobs for the people surrounding the university. So I agree with you. As a former commander, I want the best places to stay open to serve our troops when we send them in harm's way. And I can tell you that Wright-Patterson is one of them. Nobody does the research development, the logistics, as well as Wright-Patt. And as a headquarters, like I said, it's never going to close. We just want to do, you know, things like when we closed down 444, cutting through the base, there was a security breach. Once we did that, then we got rid of the fences and closed it off at either end. Now they can develop along. They can do things they couldn't do before. Had the state had a little money, we could have pitched in. And let me tell you, other states, Connecticut has put in $100 million secured bonding for a sub base. So this is, again, we're not in the lead, but we're following suit on things that we ought to do just to be competitive, put us on a level playing field. Does that help?
No, I guess not. I can understand that having a base here or anywhere can contribute to economic development, but if we don't actually need the facility, then it's not really contributing to the country.
Couldn't agree more, but the BRAC Commission will determine that. But you know what? Have you ever been to the base? Have you had a tour? I would offer up to all you folks, whoever hasn't been to the base in a while, or ever, we can do a 3 or 4 hour tour, and you can see some, again, not to judge if they belong or not, but to see what they do and how they do it. I'd be happy to set that up.
No, I'm not questioning Wright-Patterson Air Force Base. I'm just questioning if we should be trying to make it more difficult to close the base, if it really makes sense to close the base.
Right. And that's much too much detail for us to get in here, the worthiness of keeping it open. I can tell you that it is one of the strongest bases, and it does its mission very well, but the BRAC Commission is going to do that, and the things that we can do will be secondary issues, not the mission. The mission comes first, and that's what they're going to look at. That's a great concern. Aviation fuel tax, I talked about that, $6 million a year, and public library funding, we got them with that $20 million up to where they were several years ago, so they're very happy. Our libraries, when the economy's good and when it's bad, the libraries are always strong, and we need to do that. They do so much more than just books nowadays.
So does Greene County Library get?
Absolutely. Talk to Carl. He is just thrilled.
Yes.
Carl Cologne.
And Rick was very involved. Carl worked with Rick. Rick was very involved personally and received a commendation from Carl Cologne and the Greene County Library Board for his work on that.
Well, thank you.
The only thing you know that?
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you.
I hope I didn't. The only thing I would ask you, we're talking about restoring funds, is municipal local government funds.
You know, I got a little something there, but we can talk more about that.
Okay.
So the budget overall of $1.2 billion in tax relief to Ohioans, maintaining Medicaid, but looking at how we can make it more efficient. Real quick on Medicaid, back in the 80s, it was like 8% of our general fund budget. Today, it's almost 30%. It continues to grow, and it's a zero-sum game. So when that grows, everything else shrinks, including education. So we just got to do it in a manner that makes sense. And again, I said I'm not afraid of copying from other states and learning lessons. If something works in another state, we're ready to look at it and see if it'll work in the state of Ohio. School funding, I think you all know that we didn't go lower than everyone had in the past biennial. But in fact, Yellow Springs schools were one of the big winners, huge winners by percent. They got over $600,000 more this year. And the way I understand it is they had some ceilings on how much more you can get. They took a couple of those caps off. One of them, you should be proud of, had to do with achievements, testing. And so you guys here scored so well that you met some of those, and that helped get $600,000. And I know what's your superintendent?
Mario.
He's wonderful, and I know he's excited about that, doing great things. And then at the higher ed level, trying to reduce costs for families. And again, of course, there's a lot more to it than that. Yellow Springs, as I said, 16 and 17 increase of 21 and 11% respectively, and that was one of the leaders in the entire state. Hardly anyone got anything close to that. And you see the quote there, you can read it, just saying that we've put more money where we need to put more money. Local government funds, we will continue the share that we have now. And towards your question, I think we have enough local government officials like me that they're not going to go after any more money there. And as a matter of fact, when we talk in private, we talk about how we can get them more money and restore it. A lot of county commissioners, a lot of city officials, township officials, village officials that are now in the state legislators that understand the value of that money. So I think we're going to be safe.
Okay.
$20 million increase in Innovation Council, about that's for safety. And it ties into the recommendation of the Ohio Task Force on Community Police Relations. $2 million of that specifically for communities that implement any of those recommendations. Indigent fund, they've been cutting, the state's been cutting that. They restored a lot of it, and I know the folks at the county are pleased with that. Anticipated issues, Medicaid. By far the biggest expense, and it's getting bigger every day. Clearly, General Assembly is going to keep Medicaid. We're not talking about taking it off the books anymore, but we are talking about measures we can do to make it more effective and efficient. And again, I can share some of those with you at another time. Common Core, it looks like we're going to have a bill to get rid and repeal Common Core and go back to the old standards, which, interestingly enough, was the Massachusetts standards, but the state of Massachusetts has gone to Common Core. It's really interesting getting involved in that, but we're going to have a lot of discussion on Common Core. Second Amendment rights, there's discussion about Constitution carry, which means you won't need a permit. Other states have done this. So it's just a discussion. It hasn't gone anywhere, but that people can carry the right weapons, the legal weapons, as they see fit. Elections, just a warning there that the way we work here in the state, every 2 years we have to run, so after the new year, a lot of my peers, including myself, will be busy campaigning, so not a whole lot gets done. That's just the way it works. Yes, ma'am.
So I'm not sure if I understood you, but did you say that Ohio may pass a law that makes it easier for people to carry guns?
No, there's a bill that's being proposed that will make it easier, but it hasn't even gotten through committee. So it's just in a committee where we get proponent testimony, opponent testimony, and try to understand what's going on.
And what are you in favor or not?
You know what? I can't tell you. I believe in the Second Amendment. Let me say that. But until I hear this and hear what's going on in other states, I can't render a judgment. There'll be a lot of discussion, and you guys will be able to read about it and show up if you have druthers one way or the other. It's a big issue, but not the biggest issue. I'm getting to that. The biggest issues, did you have more on that, ma'am?
I mean, I think it's a huge issue.
I agree. And there are going to be people on both sides of the camp. So when it's time
I'm
to talk, you're more than welcome. I'm in the state government committee, and that's where we're going to hear it. So I'll make sure that you guys know when it's coming up. And please, and for the audience members, if anyone wants to come, State House is yours. You have every right to go up there and say what you believe one way or the other and talk to me as your representative and make sure I understand where you stand on that. Redistricting, issue one is going to come up, and this is where we're trying to legitimately trying to make districting nonpartisan. Working with the D's, now the R's are in control, Republicans, working with the Democrats. So they're forming a commission that's going to require 2 Democrats out of 7, 2 Republicans out of 7, and then state officials, the treasurer, the secretary of state, and 2 support the districting, and there's requirements there, they're going to have two Democrats approve it, two Republicans approve it. That's never been tried before. So this is really a step in a direction to, you, in the past, as you all well know, the Republicans are in power, they gerrymander it the way they want. The Democrats do the same thing, and they try to keep power as long as they can, and that's not doing justice. And the Secretary of State is firmly behind this, so we'll see where this one goes.
But if there's seven, you said there's seven on the commission, there's going to be...
There's one House majority, one Senate majority, one House minority, one House Senate minority. That's four. And then the Secretary of State, Secretary, the Treasurer, and one other state officials on
it. But they're probably Republicans.
Now they're Republicans, but they could be Democrats in the future. But the key is you have to have two of each say yes for it to go.
Okay.
And there's got to be some, you know, I'll tell you this. Two Democrats aren't going to vote for something if it doesn't work, and two Republicans aren't going to vote. They'll stand firm. And then it goes to, you know, the next alternative isn't a real good one, but instead of it standing for 10 years, it stands for 4 years while they try to work something else out. So there's effort going on there, I can tell you, to try to make it better suited for, you know, instead of the district going like this, you know, make it contiguous to the area that you're trying to support. And then, of course, issue two and three. Issue two is to prevent monopolies. And issue three is by Responsible Ohio to legalize marijuana in a manner where you have 10 specific plots throughout the state, and only those 10 can harvest the marijuana. And that's a huge issue, and at another time, I can't even pause. We can talk about the pros and cons of both of that. And just so you know, ma'am, I am... strongly against legalizing marijuana. And I'd be happy to share my reasons why. Again, I've got 10 minutes. I can't do it now.
I'm not asking you.
I'd be happy to. But that's going to be another issue that we got to make sure that the residents are well advised and educated so they understand what they're voting on, whether it's yes or no.
I don't think you're going to probably find people more educated about it than in Yellow Springs.
You know, I recently read, I mean, there's, you know, kind of two propositions here. So, I mean, how do you feel about monopolizing that?
Well, I'll tell you very briefly, I'm not so concerned about marijuana, and especially in the medical use. What I'm concerned about is the way they're going about doing this is they're changing our Constitution, and that is... Absolutely. So we got the people that have the money, multimillionaires, that are putting $30 million in the air to try to exclusively own the rights for those 10 sites. No one else is going to be able to buy into that. Now, what they'll tell you is you can buy into the retail stores, and that's mm-hmm. true. But that's not, I mean, the big money's here. That retail stores isn't the big money. It's people that are rich trying to make more money. And I guess the biggest issue is our Constitution is not the place to do it. That's not for private gain. That's a sacred document in my eyes.
I do have a question. Does that, so if issue two is voted favorably, does that automatically...
Great question. So that's a great question. Because they're in conflict, right? So the Secretary of State's opinion is if two passes and three won't pass because that's creating a monopoly. But other people are saying this is going to go to court. If both of them pass, it'll go to court, it'll drag on, and they'll have to get the legal system involved to figure out which one trumps what or how it affects each other. That's a great question. Thank you. Mid-biennial review is just the budget review and mid-year, so we try to adjust things, so we usually do that, and if there's some mistakes or there's more money being spent or not being spent in Medicaid, we figure out what we can do with it, how we should do that. And the capital budget, this is very important. Let me foot stomp this. This is money from the state, and they usually define what the capital interest is, whether it's education or sometime, last year it was a lot to do with arts, right? And then you guys tell me what you need in the village, and then I go and advocate for that. And you know, I got probably $300,000 last year for Fairborn for their sports complex to get more activity on 444, and that was a big win. So if you have something you think fits in, and we don't know the issue yet, what the effort energy is going to be spent on, the governor will say that. But once we get that, then if you have something, So you need to be talking, we need to get a game plan together, then I need to advocate for you in Columbus. There's going to be money there.
And when in 2016, when should we be looking for this?
We should know what we're going to do in the spring.
Okay.
And then I will come to you, and I will go to all the cities and villages and townships that I represent and say, look, this is what we're doing, this is the theme. If you have anything, let me know, and let's start working on it right away.
Well, but it'll be Kasich, I mean, it will come out before that. I mean, if anybody's paying attention to the paper, it will hit the paper, and we'll at least know.
But last time, not many people got a hold of me.
Well,
and the fact of the matter is, Governor Kasich is kind of busy now. I don't know how that's going to slow things down. And so we got to be ready for anything. But I would just start thinking about some of the projects, if it's infrastructure, you know, some of the projects you guys could put forward and start working with me now. I'm a civil engineer by background, so I get that kind of stuff.
So what are the parameters on that? What are we talking about? Any kind of infrastructure? Or?
Well, no, that was an example. Like I said, the arts entertainment was, because they don't put a lot into that. That
so
was
what about
last
sidewalks?
One. Well, if it's infrastructure, sidewalks would work. And, you know, we're looking into terms of if it's a $2 million project, it'll never fly. But if it's a couple hundred thousand, I might be able to do it. And yeah, and if you guys can pitch in some, you know, that raises it a little bit. So just something to think about, and I'll be in touch as we figure out what we're going to do. But that usually happens in the off summer.
Excuse me.
Yes, ma'am.
And when does that funding become available? If say we were to talk to you in the spring, would it be another year?
Inside of a year. In the case of Fairborn, the money was available well before the design was done, and they were ready. They bid it. They had to bring it back because it was over the bid authorization, and so the money was there a long time before. But when you're ready for the money, sometimes it could take months. So you know, and I'll work with you if we get to that point to make sure we get in a timely manner.
Got you.
Capital budget, Ann. Okay, this is important. This is my information and my aide below. So if anyone here or anyone in the audience wants a copy of this presentation or has any questions, call that number and my aide will give me your number. I'll call you back or we'll dialogue somehow. But here's where I say, I go back to what I started with. I work for you folks. I'm your representative. My office is your office. I'm just sitting in it. So I invite you to come to Columbus, see what I do, sit through a session, see how it happens. A lot of history in Columbus. There's a tour that takes you through the State House. Abraham Lincoln passed through there 3 or 4 times. They have all the stories. It's good for kids to come. I love for students to come, scouts to come. And I think anyone that knows me would tell you I'm sincere in this, and my aide knows that. So if you have family members, you have students, you have scouts, you name it, or you just want to go with your husband or wife, give us a call and we'll set something up and you'll get to see us in action. That could be good, that could be bad, but it is what it is, and I'd like for you to see it and be a part of it. So, ma'am, any questions?
Municipal income tax. Are you guys done messing around with it?
You know, that's never even gotten to the House.
Well, the House Bill 5 got to the House, and that had put some extra rules and
I thought that was in the Senate. I thought this
was
in the Senate.
Well, it was House Bill 5, and then I think it was finally passed by the Senate.
Mm-hmm. Right.
That was back in 2014, wasn't it?
So this is about somebody wants to only tax income tax to the residents,
that's
not to people that work.
That's a whole new thing.
Oh, I'm sorry. Okay, that's what I was thinking of.
Yeah. House Bill 5 was last year, and that was the one that it didn't change. It was the one that what's the word? Made the filing a little bit easier. But what it also did was it went in and it did put some rules on that dramatically impacted the amount of income tax that some municipalities
and you were against that,
were
right?
receiving. Yeah, I mean, I don't think any municipality wasn't.
Right.
Yeah,
I don't
the Ohio
think we
Municipal
impacted.
League came out pretty
yeah.
strongly
against
it. I don't
think
it.
That we were
Yeah, and that
correctly.
Was a tough one. I got to tell you, because what they were, what the crafters of that bill was trying to do was make Ohio as a state more attractive to outside businesses. And we hear a lot, and I think you heard a lot, that, you know, you've got 100, 300 different filing systems, and when one company is doing business in every, they've got to do all this. It's mm-hmm. just, it gets so complicated. So that was the impetus of it.
And that makes sense. I absolutely agree with that. It's just that they changed rules about the length of time somebody could could be in a municipality working. There were just a lot of rule changes that did significantly impact probably larger municipalities more than us. And you know, certainly if the income tax based on residence would ever go, you know, to be honest with you, it might favor Yellow Springs, mm-hmm. but I think generally as a rule, I think that the partnership, the kind of partnership of municipalities investing in providing jobs and bringing jobs and bringing business to town, that would destroy that.
I got to tell you, when you mentioned it to my aide, I looked it up. That was the first time I've heard it because it's in the Senate side.
Okay.
But I'm pleased to get that. And that's a great lesson. If you guys see something before I do, I've got one person helping me. So I don't get all the information.
Okay.
So if you see something, you read something, and it doesn't sound right or you got a problem with it, call me and let me know so I'm not blindsided. And when we get in caucus, I can make sure that I advocate for you if that's where we're going to be. Sir.
Yeah, can you flesh out a little bit what you were talking about with just sort of the with police departments and, you know, sort of you mentioned implementing certain initiatives and that.
So we established a $20 million pot. Wrong subject. I'm sorry. Kitty for public safety enhancements. Mm-hmm. So if you guys wanted to buy a new if you guys want to buy a new cruiser, that's the kind of money you can try to tap into to get it. That there's specifically $2 million of that is going to be fenced off for any. You know, they had this. What was it called, Chief? Community relations after the shootings and what went on, and they came up with some recommendations. If you're doing any of those recommendations, and they're online, you can see what the recommendations are, then you would be eligible for some of that $2 million. So yeah, I think you guys ought to look at that carefully, and if it's confusing or if you're not sure, contact my aide Andy and we'll talk to the right people. We won't know the answer, but we'll find it for you.
And does that include training?
Training would be part of a safety enhancement. Training would absolutely be part of it.
Okay.
You know, $20 million doesn't go a long ways when you're talking the whole state. So I would say, you know, look at that carefully, quickly. And if you think you qualify for something, let me help you figure out that you do in fact qualify. And I'll be happy to work with you, Chief. And then let's go ahead and put the application. And all I can say is no, right? Mm-hmm. It doesn't hurt. They can't say yes if you don't put it in. And I know that even a couple hundred thousand goes a long ways for, you know, a village as small as Yellow Springs.
Oh, absolutely. So. And we have really been doing a lot of training. And I really applaud the chief for encouraging him doing some of the training and encouraging our department. It seems like every week there's a new training program going on. So hopefully we're taking advantage of that funding. And Chief and Melissa can probably look into that.
Well, and again, use us if you need some help. Don't spin your wheels too long before you say, we don't understand this. And we'll get with the right people in public safety.
Any other comments or questions?
Yeah, I have two things.
Yes, ma'am.
One is, I guess, a year old, but that's doing away with the state estate tax really hit Yellow Springs hard. And, of course, the state estate tax, doing away with it is a way to help rich people. Rich people are the only ones that have estate taxes high enough to have to pay estate taxes. So it's made a difference of $200,000 to $400,000 a year for Yellow Springs, which is significant for us.
Mm-hmm.
So I suppose it's not possible to reinstate the estate tax, but that would certainly be a help for communities.
Anything's possible. That would be a tough hurdle because that was a tough one to come off the books. But a little different angle on that is, you know, a lot of that money was going down to Florida anyway. We weren't seeing it. They'd go down before it was viable for us because the people that make that kind of money know it, and they know where they can keep the money and hand it down to their children and grandchildren. So they go to states and they retire in Florida because they don't have an estate tax. So a lot of that's leaving the state. And you know that was the big picture of why they started that, is to make it more attractive for people, wealthy people, to stay here and pay their share through other taxes that we have. So I'm not saying that's right or wrong. It's just kind of the justification that they went through on that. I know it hurts you guys.
Yeah, The other thing is something that we, I think, just found out this year that impacts people running for office. We had three people who were going to run for village council, and at least two of those, their petitions were thrown out because they weren't given help at the county level. And apparently, it's a recent decision by the Secretary of State of Ohio that the election board cannot tell people who bring in their petitions, hey, did you know you forgot to have this notarized, or, oh, wow, you're using the wrong form. And there's been a lot of concern about
that. Have you guys had those kind of problems?
Yes.
I got to tell you, so you go
Miami
and you put
County.
In your petition, and they don't help you if you have a question?
No. Right. No, I mean, it's not
And they
legal.
Tell you they can't.
Yeah, Judy, I think, is probably the best person to address it because she spoke to the Board of Elections.
Yeah, the representative at the Board of Elections said, yes, we used to be able to do that, but it's the recent mandate that they are not permitted to.
So I know when it comes down to voting, they've kind of distanced themselves from the responsibility of that, but let me find out about that. Let me see what directive they've gotten, and let me see if the interpretation is what they're actually doing. Because a lot of people.
Who made
this? Yes, it was a second.
Well, he would be the one to do it. I'll look at that. You know, the fact of the matter is many people when they run, and well, you guys were there, I was there, it's your first time, you have no clue what you're doing, you just want to do something different and help, and we shouldn't make that more
and
difficult.
That's who it hurts mostly.
Right.
And, I mean, other communities had many more people, actually. I think Miami County had like a quarter or something of the people that ran were tossed out.
And you're saying you're attributing that because they didn't get the help they needed.
Yeah. Right. Well, let me
get back to you on that. Let me look into that a little bit. I'd be happy to.
Great, thanks.
And I'd like to just say that I started kind of at a planning, and then I was a mayor, so I know what you guys are doing, and I just appreciate, and I talk to people all the time about they want to do more for the community, and I know it's not always easy and it takes a lot of time, but I appreciate, for one, you folks stepping up and doing something to make your community and your state better than it was before you got there, because I know that close up. So thank you, and thank you for the time.
Thank you, Rick. Okay, where did my agenda go? Here it is. Any other announcements? Or any announcements?
Well, I have something that a citizen brought to me, and I'm not sure where it should be on the agenda, but it's about drones flying over the village.
That's not an announcement. Let's put it in petitions and communications, maybe to. Is it something you want to add to the agenda?
It's about a concern about legislation regarding.
Okay.
I have a couple announcements. I wanted to mention the Public Arts Commission meeting has been moved to September 16th, and I believe the Energy Board meeting.
It's September 22nd, not.
Oh, not the 15th.
No, not the 15th. The 22nd.
Mm. Okay. So we got to fix that sign. And then I just wanted to remind citizens that we are soliciting members for the Utility Dispute Resolution Board and also the Economic Sustainability Commission. And Rick, while I'm thinking about it, I want to give you a Yellow Springs pin. Everybody loves that I did this.
It does.
But it's not. Yeah. Thanks again.
Okay, is that it?
Yes.
Okay. Next is the consent agenda. We have the minutes of August 24th special council meeting and the financials for August of 2015. I would like to pull out the minutes because there was something I wanted to add to them. Is that okay with everybody?
Yeah. Sure.
Okay. So I guess we can do the consent agenda for the budget or for the financials.
Second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Okay. I don't know if anybody else had any comments on the minutes, but what I had noted was, in old business, page 6. Well, should we just go through them all? Does anybody else have anything? Okay. On page 6, where we were discussing the ICLEI membership, there, it says, McQueen commented that the Green Space Fund would be an appropriate source of the $600 annual fee. And I think that actually later in the discussion, both Lori and I said we would actually prefer it not coming out of the Green Space Fund and that we would want it to come out of the council budget.
Yes.
So I would like that added.
And again, we do have that special, you know, membership, right, you know, line item, so.
Right. Any other changes while we're looking at them? Okay. Motion to approve as amended?
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Thank you. Oh, gosh, Lori's not here. Is anybody else prepared to do petitions and communications?
I think I can do it.
Okay, go ahead.
All right, so let me just pull that up. So we had a... we talked about this at the last meeting, but we had the letter that was revised to the city of Cleveland in support of transgender accommodations. And, you know, as a council, we all agreed that we signed off on that. We have Marsha Walgren's letter, which I think we'll be discussing later on. Oh, and there's Lori right there. I'm taking your...
Yeah, please do.
although we actually missed agenda review, but go ahead and finish then with
okay.
The agenda review.
And so, yeah, I believe when we like talk about the grant application, we'll be looking at that more. But Marsha's main concern was that we needed to think about Vernet's impact on the water. We've got the Green County Parks and Trails levy, which I think is very important that we think about supporting. It supports our parks, it supports bike trails, something I think that's very important for Yellow Springs. We have the NVRPC photo contest, which is actually really cool. They're looking for folks to submit photos of places around Greene County and you know things that just kind of capture what we're all about, and then of course we have the mayor's monthly assessment of what's going on. Those were the main ones that I saw in the packet.
Okay.
So.
Well, we had local government fund allocations. It showed that we are getting our allocation for 2016 is $98,763, which is actually a small amount higher than in
right.
2014 or 2015.
Which, by the way, was not in the online packet, so that's part of why
oh.
I couldn't speak to that.
And the other one was about the bicycle plan. When
which,
is that? That meeting's already.
Yes, that happened last Wednesday.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
And who sent us the local government allocations? I read right over that and didn't notice, but it was not in the online packet.
Yeah.
What's the source on that?
Greene County. Was it from Greene County?
Yeah, it was Greene County.
Yeah. So, yeah, I didn't.
Greene County just sent it, like, sent it over to Judy.
Yeah, how did you get it, Judy? Did you get it via email or did you?
Yeah, and then I sent it on to Melissa and I thought I had it in the packet.
Could you maybe make sure there's notes on here, like where it came from?
Yeah, whenever
that
there's
is kind
anything,
of,
anything in the packet, it'd be helpful to know.
This is actually not what I put in the packet. There was a long...
Melissa brought this tonight because Karen had asked her to
right.
for previous
but
years.
This thing.
Allocation.
This was in the packet?
This was in the paper packet,
apparently. It was not in the online packet.
Okay.
Wasn't in the paper.
Sure?
I thought it was.
I would guess it would be at the end. But
yeah, I thought it was in there. But
I might have missed it.
Two people are saying it wasn't in there, so.
I'm not.
I saw it somewhere. I'll look for it.
Okay. So we missed review of agenda. Let's go back to that.
And there was a letter from Athena Fannin. Which I think was just a copy of what she said at the last council
right.
meeting.
Right.
It was, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh.
Also not in the online packet.
No.
Right.
So
it should have been, it should be. There's a lot
there were multiple problems with the online packet, so it got added. It should be there now.
Oh, okay.
There it is.
Well, I usually just open the one that gets emailed to me, so.
So are you saying, Judy, that, that council members should probably go to the website? Even council members should go to the website and download that packet?
Yeah, I would say so. I mean, there were a number of things. For one thing, the financials wrapped themselves into obliviousness, and they were unreadable, so we redid that whole session.
Yeah, there was problems with that.
There was a lot that had to get redone.
Yeah.
Normally, that does not happen.
Can we check, maybe check to make sure that we're sending out a good packet to council members before we send it out? That went out from?
That went out from Patty.
Patty, okay.
Yeah.
Not this Patty.
And my PDF that went on looked reasonably okay, and then it's a computer issue.
Okay.
Yeah, the local government revenue, that page with all of the, that page, yes, is just before the mayor's. I downloaded my packet this morning.
Okay, well, it was, I just opened the one that Patty sends, because that's what sent to me.
I didn't add that. That's been there.
Yeah.
Well, I've searched for these terms. I'm not, and there was no, this time there was no table of contents, so.
Yeah, she added all those things. I have no explanation as to why it was so completely messed up, but.
Okay, well.
Let's just, let's make sure we're all getting the same information. Okay, so review of agenda, we've added, we've talked about, one thing is on our table, Resolution 2015-35, about our membership in Regional Planning and Coordinating Commission. We need to have an action on that by September 22nd, so I told Patty we could put it on the agenda. And then Mary Ann just brought up the issue of maybe a very quick review or discussion of the drone situation, not to get to any sort of conclusion, but we'll add that to new business. See if it's something that we can assign for a discussion item for the next meeting. Anything else to be added to the agenda or changed? Okay, we've got a lot of legislation. Second reading and public hearing of Ordinance 2015-08. We'll just read all of these in by title only.
Okay, this is Ordinance 2015-08, vacating an alley at the easternmost portion of North College Street.
Patty, do you want to, can?
Do you want to take a motion?
Oh, I'm sorry, motion.
So move. Second.
This is a recommendation that John made before he left, and it has been before the Planning Commission. They recommend to council that we vacate East North College Street between Livermore and Corey Streets. It runs through the Antioch campus, and Antioch plans, I believe, to put a paved walkway there. Reggie Stratton, I see him out there, and I'm sure he'll be happy to answer any other questions. But this has kind of been on our radar for a while. There were some issues. Reggie worked with our staff and got those straightened out, and it went before planning. Planning does recommend to council that you pass this.
Jerry or Lori, I don't know which. Jerry, do you have any comments?
I think a couple of significant things. One was making sure we had fire access.
Correct.
That would cut through the campus, and that whatever walkway that they put in would be strong enough to support the vehicles, plus any growth would not obstruct the height of the vehicles going through. Okay. And the third one was that if we had to make repairs to our lines, sewer water, if I'm correct.
Correct.
That we would only replace it with gravel. We wouldn't put it back to the state that the college.
Right, and the college would put back the pavers if that became necessary.
Reggie, do you have some comments? Do you want to come up and say anything?
Yeah, sure. So. Hi, everyone.
You might introduce yourself for anybody in the listening audience who maybe doesn't know.
I'm Reggie Stratton. I'm with Antioch College, the physical plant director. So, just to address the three concerns that Jerry brought up, as far as the structural strength, we would agree to the condition of making the paver's foundation strong enough to handle the fire truck. Make sure the overhead clearance is there. And what was the third one?
The third one was if we had to make repairs and we had to tear it out.
Yeah, we understand if you had to come in and repair infrastructure. You would fill it with gravel, and then we'd be responsible to repave it. So sure, we're happy to comply with all those conditions.
So this is a public hearing. It's a second reading and public hearing. I will open the floor to citizen comments. You need to come up to the podium and state your name, and you have 3 minutes for comments. Mr. Myers?
And just so folks know, this timer is not working, so I'll just let you know when your 3 minutes is up in a gentle fashion.
Okay. Henry Myers, 247 Whitehall. I'm here about to talk about the economic development thing.
Oh, no, this is just comments about this legislation that we're hearing right now.
Oh, sorry.
We'll have you up during citizen concerns.
Sorry.
Thank you.
That's all right. Thank you.
Any comments? Seeing and hearing none, I'll bring it back to council table for a vote.
All right. Esklin?
Yeah.
Sims?
Yes.
McQueen?
Yes.
Hausch?
Yes.
Wintrow?
Yes. Next, we have second reading and public hearing of ordinance 2015-11.
This is vacating an alley right-of-way along an eastern portion of Herman Street.
Can I have a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Patty or Jerry, who would?
Again, this is another situation that's been ongoing for a while. There were some concerns about the access to our sewer main that runs through this property. I believe there was a fence that Antioch wishes to install. So there was an agreement reached about 24-hour access into the property through the gate. Should we need that to access our manholes or our line? This did go before the Planning Commission, and it is their recommendation that council also accept this vacation.
Okay. Any other comments or questions from council? Reggie, do you feel like you need to? I mean, if you don't feel like you need to add anything, then
no,
Jerry.
Just for everybody's, I mean, our motivation for both of these vacations is to make the campus bike and pedestrian friendly. And on the Herman Street, we do plan to expand our garden, and that's where we need the fence that Karen mentioned. So when we expand the garden, there'll be a perimeter fence to keep animals out, deer, rabbits, whatever. And so we agreed to a gate that would not be locked and 16-foot wide, I believe, for the truck access to the sanitary. And again, we're happy to comply with those conditions.
Thank you, Reggie. This is a public hearing. I will open the floor to any public comments. Seeing and hearing none, I'll come back to council table for the roll call.
Yes, Hausch?
Yes.
Sims?
Yes.
McQueen?
Yes.
Esklin?
Yes.
Wintrow?
Yes. Next, we have resolution 2015-32.
This is authorizing the village manager to submit an application to the Ohio Public Works Commission's Clean Ohio Conservation Program for conservation for the riparian corridor located within the Glass Farm.
Can I have a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Okay. I will turn this over to Patty or Mary Ann.
Mary Ann can.
Okay. The concept of this would be that we would be applying for a grant with Tecumseh Land Trust. And actually, Tecumseh Land Trust would be the lead applicant. On Sunday, Tom Dietrich, myself, Vicki Hennessy, walked the area with Krista McGaugh, Michelle Burns, and several of the Tecumseh board members. The Tecumseh board doesn't meet till later this month, and they have to approve going forward. I know that Marcia is in the audience and has raised concerns about potential contamination. What I know at this point is that Vicki Hennessy has been in contact with the EPA. We have, to date, no information about whether or not there is existing contamination. I know I've talked with Tom and also Jessica D'Ambrosio at Antioch, who's on the Environmental Commission. And if Tom wants to say anything, Tom can. And Patty, I think you had some input that you...
If I understand Marcia's letter correctly, her concern is that there is a potential, legitimate potential for the contamination from the Vernet site to go into that creek and subsequently on down to the wetland area. That's a legitimate concern, and there's not been any testing of the water in the creek. The remediation for the problem at Vernet for the spill is ongoing. The EPA has not approved a final remediation plan yet, but that the EPA will likely, if they hold true to my experience with them, probably approve several versions of a final plan and adjust that as time goes on. So this will be an ongoing remediation. It's not going to end anytime in the near future. I do get monthly reports about the remediation, and it is continuing to abate. I think Marcia's concerns are legitimate that we should probably test that water, and we do have a contract with a testing laboratory, and it will not be a problem to take those samples and send those off. I don't have an issue with doing that at all, and it would be good to monitor that. I will say that the ecosystem there seems to support quite a diversity of wildlife, and that is generally a pretty good indicator of a healthy habitat and a healthy ecosystem. I also believe that the wetland is probably helping to cleanse that, you know, but it's a legitimate concern. I don't know that I think that it should hold us up in applying for the grant, but I do think I agree with Marcia that it should be monitored.
Mm-hmm.
So.
I guess I have two questions. So one was, what I read in the packet said that the recommendation was for the village to take the lead, so that's been changed to?
Yeah, it's because of the regulations for Clean Ohio.
Okay.
I guess it's because Tecumseh would hold the easement.
Gotcha.
And I believe
that's why
they would be the lead.
Yeah, okay. If they're going to hold the easement, then yes, they have to be the lead.
And then the second thing, the invitation for council to do the walk, I guess the walk's already happened. Okay.
Well, we can do more walks.
Oh, yeah. Okay. I just wanted to check.
I need to go back out there anyway because I found a plant that nobody can identify. And
all right.
Take
me along then.
Yeah.
Well, I have a question. You know, it was saying Tecumseh on the easement, but, you know, we have a retention pond out there that was mm-hmm. put in for, mm-hmm. you know, flood prevention and
correct.
So forth. What effect on them holding the easement will have on us having
none? None. The easement will have to be written so that we can still maintain that retention pond to do what it's supposed to do, and that'll be part of the easement. That shouldn't be a problem.
Okay.
I mean, they hold the easement on this project in the back here as well. So
okay, I've got it. So when is all of this going to happen? I mean, so when are we going to find out about the grant? Will the easement happen even if we don't get the grant? I mean, is all of this going to the Tecumseh easement dependent upon the grant?
Well, at this point, yeah, the easement is dependent. It's all one package. And it's due at the end of October. The grant application is due. I'm not sure when we would find out. But the Tecumseh Land Trust Board doesn't meet until a couple weeks, I think.
What we did the last time was we didn't pass the easement. We didn't approve the easement on this project until after the funding was secured.
Okay. Okay.
So you do not have to approve the easement prior to the funding. It just has to be done before work starts.
Okay.
I don't know if Marcia or Tom.
The other question I have is, it is proposed to have 5 parking spaces?
That's kind of, I advocate for a few more than that myself, but that's kind of up in the air. There were discussions about what we thought we could expect out there.
And the only reason I ask that question is are we saying that we're going to limit it to 5 parking spaces? Can 20 cars still go in there?
No.
It's good. Yeah, there's not going to be room
okay.
back there for that.
Okay.
there's a very limited space for parking.
Well, I mean, people make room.
Right, and is there turnaround? I mean, if somebody, are they going to know before they turn down the lane if they can go back, and then what are they going to do?
Probably not. They'll just have to go through, just like we do.
Okay.
You can pull all the way through and out onto the unimproved part of the...
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Oh, so that is open then?
Okay. Yeah.
Okay.
Let's open it up for citizen comment. Marcia, I see you're craning your neck. Would you like to speak?
I'm Marcia Walgren. I am part of a group of citizens that have court-ordered oversight of the Vernet property cleanup. And the property is under a corrective action with US EPA Region 5. That's in Chicago. And it hasn't been cleaned up yet, as you said, Patty. And a solution hasn't been devised yet, but they are working on that.
Mm-hmm. Marcia, I didn't hear your last sentence.
Oh, I said they haven't cleaned up yet.
Right.
There is no cleanup yet, and the solution, the final solution hasn't been decided yet.
Okay. Right.
There has been testing. The testing of the creek and the sediment, basically the US EPA wants more characterization of that and wants to prevent people from being exposed to it.
Mm-hmm.
There were three mailings to the residents that's also on their website. These were basically telling us about the progress of the site, and they were quite clear that that is one of the routes of exposure, that they identified, you know, people who could be exposed to the pollution now and in the future. They were plant workers, construction workers, trespassers on the property, people on neighboring property digging in the soil, and exposure to the water in the stream. Mm-hmm. So they don't want waders in the stream. So my concern is attracting animals. I've been told this is a great way to clean up land, but it's like, do we want to attract animals and filter contamination through small animals?
Yeah.
But I'm more concerned with people, their children, and their pets, because we've been told not to go in the creek. So I don't know how you would prevent that. Vicki said something about putting up signs, and I know that that doesn't keep people out of the Cascades in the Glen.
Mm-hmm.
So we're talking, I think before they were talking about attracting people to visit there, and I'm just like, I think it's premature just because we don't know yet what this corrective action process is going to be. You know, EPA is asking them to characterize this contamination further as far as the creek goes. I do know that as far, I wish I had something I could show everyone, but, you know, this is my neighborhood, and there's three plumes of contamination that are heading east, okay? They didn't, I think they just touched Wright Street when this was done, and now they go down to Green Street. They put in two extra monitoring wells to try to stop that. But this line is the sewer outfall that goes up to the creek. And what was found in the sediment and the water, as they tested as far as Fairfield Pike, so that's all the way down King Street to Fairfield. And what they found above MCLs, which is the maximum contaminant level, were three chemicals, which were trichloroethylene, tetrachloroethylene, and 1,2-dichloroethylene. So all three of those have been found in sediment samples, and what the EPA has said in the past and what our guy has said basically is right here we have a storm sewer line. It bisects the property, and there's storm sewers all along there. And until that's blocked off, or until Vernet removes that, it will continue. That is not being taken care of by the monitoring wells. The monitoring wells are trying to take care of the groundwater plumes of three chemicals. So this sewer outfall has not been addressed. So that contamination is not going to stop until it has been addressed.
Mm-hmm.
And actually, we're in an area over here where up to 1 million parts per billion have been found in the soil. So maximum contaminant level is 5 parts per million. So that shows you it is a high priority site, and that is why. So that is the area that's getting into this, and my concern is people, attracting people, children, their pets, and even small animals. It's just like, I don't think that's the best way to clean up the site.
Mm-hmm. Your time is up.
Okay.
Thanks, Marcia.
You bet.
Can we ask?
If we want to extend the time, go ahead.
Do you have information about when the last tests on the stream were done and what the results of those tests were?
I know that we could ask we have a consultant, we have a hydrogeology firm that basically does input on what Vernet's cleanup. They have their experts, the neighbors have their experts, and that expertise is
so you don't
shareable.
Know if it's been done within
it's
the last
been done,
decade?
No. Most of the main studies that were done that they're still using were in 2004. And nothing has changed to stop that area. Nothing has been cleaned up in that area. The pumping wells, the measures that have been done so far are considered interim measures. And they will continue. The pumping wells they put in to bring the plume back has actually been successful. They have pulled it off Omar. Mm-hmm. However, there's big questions about whether they are effective at all on the plume to the east. And this is a separate issue that's heading to the north. And
so,
down
so we really don't have information about what exists now. And
right. Well, they are actually, EPA is that is one of the things they are actually arguing about is to characterize it further. They want a further characterization, and they have said they don't want people exposed to it. So it's going to be, how is Vernet going to clean that up so people aren't exposed to it?
And if I understand Patty correctly, we can go and we can have our the mm-hmm. company that does our testing mm-hmm. test the stream and
sure.
the sediment
right.
at different points and see.
Well, there's a way, you know, we can, and I think any solution to remediate Vernet's contamination needs to be approved by the US EPA.
Oh, yeah.
And I'm not sure, I have questions about whether we should be embarking on or accepting liability for cleanup.
Part of what you're suggesting is that by potentially taking that water through a wetland that actually could mitigate the contamination, that we would be impacting what they are required
to do. Well, I don't know what they're going to be required to do. I mean, for all I don't know. I don't know the environmental laws. I'm not an expert. That's why
okay.
I use my own expert. But, I mean, I would even question whether they might have to clean up to a higher level just because it's going feeding into
right.
a wetland. I don't know how that will impact
okay.
the cleanup.
Okay. I mean, you're staying here, right? So if anybody has any questions, you're going to back
absolutely.
To your seat.
Absolutely.
Okay.
And my only point is I'm worried about attracting people, animals, and pets to an area that the EPA has said to stay out of. So that's my main concern.
Thanks, Marcia.
You bet.
You know, I actually wonder if, is Vernet aware of this project? They may not
yeah.
want us to do this project.
Yes, yeah. I have not spoken to Vernet or TRC about it.
I would think that they probably need to know about it.
I can contact them tomorrow.
Well,
Tom, let's have.
Hello, Tom Dietrich. I'm an Environmental Commission member and resident, and I've been working on this project. And want to start off by just saying thank you to Marcia for the work that she's been doing, representing the interest of the environment in the village for us. Really admire that. I was totally unaware of the work that you've been doing. And knew about the Vernet pollution, but I just wanted to put it out there that I appreciate that, and I'm glad you're raising this concern, and that I would like to invite you to the commission next commission meeting, or one that works for you, so that we can bring that and raise this issue with the commission, because the fact that the pollution is still there and that the that there's a lack of effort on EPA's part to get this remediated is very concerning to me as a resident. You know, setting aside this whole, the whole glass farm thing, just getting, you know, this needs to be remediated. I mean, it's been lingering too long and it needs to be fixed. So thank you for raising that. To address the question about the wetland as a treatment for the pollution, it is not the village's, in my opinion, as environmental consultant, independent consultant, not for the village, but as my opinion through as an expert in my field, would say that it is not the village's responsibility. Just because you have installed a wetland there, you are not treating their pollution, you're not liable for their pollution. If there isn't, and it sounds like there were some samples that suggest there are. Would say that so again, the intention of the wetland is not to treat those chemicals. It is merely habitat, it's not and a flood mitigation measure. That's the village's stance. So no bugs and bunnies are being, I just say that as no animals, we're not encouraging animals or plants to be harmed by those chemicals. It's not the intent. And the,
right.
They will naturally go there. Any plants and animals will and have been going there no matter what. So we can't prevent them from, or exclude them from the site. People, we can encourage to go to the site or not. And so that is a concern. If there is contaminant levels that are a risk to humans, then that could be a concern to me and to, you know, as again, to the public. But I would say that the encouragement to enter the water is minimal. If you've been there, I don't know if anyone's been there, but it's pretty mucky. And so, but there is a potential. So I'm not trying to minimize that. There is a potential for interaction if, you know, if it becomes a public space. But I don't think that there will be I don't think that installing trails or encouraging the use of the land area would necessarily encourage people being exposed. It's just my opinion. What else?
Jim,
the
10 seconds.
I still do support moving forward with the grant proposal and simultaneously moving forward with trying to get the remediation done. Thank you.
Thanks, Tom. So the issue we have at hand is that we basically have a deadline on this, on the grant request itself. I think we have some questions that need to be addressed. So can we approve the going forward with the grant request and while the investigation is going on? Is that, and then pull back the project. If something happens that we find out it is not advisable to do this project, we can just decide we aren't going to do the project.
Let's turn is to that, see what Patty, because she's,
what do you think?
Do we have the ability to do that?
Just because you passed the resolution doesn't mean you have to submit the application. Mm-hmm. We have until the end of October. Mm-hmm. My assumption would be that if you approve this, Krista and Michelle are probably going to start working on the application by the first part of October. But it's not a horrendously complicated application. So I would think that we have the month of September to get some testing done, and we can have the results probably by the work session.
But it sounds to me like you're saying that if we aren't absolutely comfortable, we shouldn't submit the application then pull it back.
I wouldn't submit it and pull it back simply because it tends to leave a bad taste in the mouth of the funders, and it's not, we are not submitting the application. Tecumseh Land Trust is, and I would not want to harm their reputation.
I mean, our resolution simply authorizes the village manager to submit.
Right.
So I think we can sign the, we can do the resolution, with the understanding that if any information comes to the attention of the village manager with regard to the potential contaminants, that she will not act on this authorization, but bring it back to council.
And but does this language change since we aren't the agent of record?
The language would have to change. It would have to be with Tecumseh Land Trust.
So what would it be? The village manager is authorized to direct Tecumseh Land Trust to submit an application?
Support Tecumseh Land Trust.
Does Tecumseh Land Trust in their submission of an application?
Do we just need one reading?
Yes.
It's a resolution.
Patty, do you think that by the 21st we could have results of tests on the water?
We could, but the 21st is a work session, so if you want to pass it on the 21st, you'll have to schedule a special meeting because you cannot pass legislation at a work session.
Then I'd say let's schedule a special meeting for this particular purpose, because I think it's just too important, not only now, but for the future, you know, I just don't feel, because this, and I live, you know, I always thought the contamination was
confined,
right. Heading to Wright Street, but now I find that it's actually going east and down. I have concern with that. Okay.
And I would say that would also, it's not just the testing, it seems to me that we have to have receive some sort of authorization or at least agreement from the EPA, mm-hmm. and that Vernet should probably be notified of the project. And have the adjacent property owners been notified?
Of the property?
Of the project.
No.
It's completely on our property, so.
Okay.
Yeah.
I mean, it already exists.
Right. So. But I would say then, you know, some sort of discussion with EPA and some sort of discussion with Vernet.
Okay, I can work on that tomorrow.
Okay.
And so, Judy, I guess we want to schedule it. I mean,
potentially input from our legal counsel, because it's I
have contact information.
Okay. You have what information?
Contact.
Oh. Okay.
Vernet's expert in.
Okay.
So when we do it, the final agenda planning piece, we can schedule that in.
Okay.
That's not a problem.
And I guess I do want to emphasize, you know, there are other aspects of this grant application that, you know, just kind of cleans up that site. And, you know, when we think about like the beaver management plan and all that, so I don't want that to get lost in the shuffle. But I agree, you know, it makes sense if we can get this testing done mm-hmm. before we make a decision. So. Mm-hmm.
Okay. And then, I mean, so we don't know at this point.
Right.
Which makes sense to do the test. If there are substantial chemicals in the water, toxic chemicals, then we need to not just think about the glass farm, but it's that whole stream.
Mm-hmm.
That's right there, too. Mm-hmm. Runs through private property.
Right. Mm-hmm.
The headwaters of Yellow Springs Creek.
Right.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Marcia?
They actually, Renee asked him to sign $25,000 because that contamination that runs down that stream, it goes underground, then it comes out of the Wines Pond, then it goes into the Old Springs Creek, then it goes into Little Miami. And the Little Miami is a navigable kind of water that is mm-hmm. why that's a violation of the water.
Right.
So that to me says there's plenty of evidence that contamination is ongoing and is there, and that piece has never been built.
And mm-hmm. I don't want to open up a can of worms, and I don't totally understand everything that Marcia was saying, but this idea of this storm sewer, and I'm wondering, it sounds like that's potentially a separate issue, and I'm wondering if there is something that we could do to encourage them to remove that storm sewer.
I think that all along I have wanted and hoped for the village itself to encourage to be on the side of getting this mess cleaned up, and a voice in getting the mess cleaned up.
We don't have, honestly, we don't have a lot of leverage.
We do have, but we have part of our settlement was a substantial amount of money to pay for an expert who has no investment whatsoever. He's going to get paid regardless, so he's not against Brene. He is trying to, he just is looking at the facts. And so there's the US EPA has their expert, Brene has an expert, and they're just trying to negotiate probably the least expensive way to get it done.
Right.
And there's, you know, we have the EPA and our expert who pretty much are saying the same thing, and they're trying to be protective of the health of the citizens and the environment and the ecosystem. And, you know, just being proactive with the US EPA, that you want to see the site getting cleaned up, we'll be very happy.
Okay, thank you. Tom, very short, just come up to the microphone, please.
Just briefly, there are measures, interim measures that you could request that Brene pay to line the storm sewer to prevent groundwater from infiltrating into the storm sewer. That's the problem, is groundwater is getting into the storm sewer. So you need the storm sewer for drainage, but one way to prevent it from getting.
Thanks, Tom. So what we are voting on now is to simply support environmental commissions and Tecumseh Land Trust application for the grant, directing Patty, but there will be testing and there will be investigation that will go on in the meantime and until council, it will be discussed at the next meeting and in the next special meeting, and until council is satisfied, it won't go forward. Or should we just hold this legislation?
I understood that we were just going to table this legislation.
Oh, okay.
So I move to table.
Okay.
Second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay. Resolution 2015-33.
This is endorsing the objectives of the Greene County Countywide Comprehensive Natural Hazard Mitigation Plan.
Can I have a motion, please?
So moved. Second.
Patty, this is totally you.
Yeah. I read this.
I got a little glassy-eyed,
but I read it.
I read it, too.
It's a very good plan. It is a countywide plan. We are required to either have our own plan or to adhere to the county plan. Most villages, because of their size, do adhere to the county plan. It's a good plan. There were a couple of issues, which I think I told council before, that I corrected, and staff discussed it a little bit at the staff meeting on how we could proceed with increasing our mitigation efforts here in the village as a village. But at this point, I recommend to council that they pass this resolution supporting and accepting the county hazard mitigation plan.
Was there any conversation with Colin Altman and the Miami Township?
Not on this. We discussed last year's, but we didn't discuss this year's. It was more of a timing thing that I got it right before I left, and I just haven't had a chance to talk to Colin.
And Patty, can you just highlight why it's important for this mitigation plan to be in place?
The mitigation plan covers virtually any disaster that could happen. It covers everything from a flood to a tornado to Hurricane Ike wind damage, essentially any kind of hazardous spill. There's a plan in place that says this is what happens if this event occurs, here's what you do. And it allows you to apply for funding. It gets everybody on the same page. If we were to have a hazard here, it would make us eligible for FEMA funding, and that can help pay quite a bit of if the crews are out on overtime. During Hurricane Ike, I'm sure that
we did.
Everybody was out on overtime clearing up branches, helping get electricity back. That type of funding pays you back, I think it's 75% of your man hours. So you have to have this mitigation plan in place in order to be eligible for that.
So. Okay.
Did I ask for a motion?
I don't think so.
Oh, can I have a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Okay. Any other discussion? Comments from citizens? Okay. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Next is resolution 2015-35.
Do you want this in its entirety?
Oh, wait, we're doing 2015-34. Where is it?
It's on the next page.
It's on the next page. Okay. 2015-34 is next. Yeah, let's read this one.
Right, this is declaring September 25th, 2015 Wilberforce Day in the Village of Yellow Springs. Whereas September 25th, 2015 will mark the inauguration of Dr. Algenia Warren Freeman as the 20th president of Wilberforce University. Whereas the Village of Yellow Springs wishes to recognize the importance of Wilberforce University to the village and to this region as the oldest historically black college in the nation. And whereas Council recognizes the significant revitalization efforts undertaken under the leadership of Dr. Algenia Warren Freeman during her first year as Wilberforce's 20th president. And whereas countless graduates, faculty, and staff of Wilberforce have lived and worked in Yellow Springs, adding to the fabric of the community. Now, therefore, the Council for the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio, hereby resolves that, Section 1. On behalf of the Village of Yellow Springs, this resolution will be presented to Dr. Algenia Warren Freeman for presentation to the Wilberforce University community with our best wishes and congratulations. Section 2, September 25th, 2015, is hereby declared to be Wilberforce Day in the Village of Yellow Springs.
Thank you. Can I have a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
I would say that was appropriate. Jerry, a graduate of Wilberforce, and Lori, the author of the letter and the resolution.
Judy was mostly. Okay. I just edited
so
the
Lori,
resolution.
You,
I wrote the letter, but I edited.
And Lori also did write a very nice letter that is accompanying this to the board. Any other comments you'd like to make? This is very nice. Thank you.
It's great.
Thank you for doing that, Lori. Comments from citizens? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. And now we've got resolution 2015-35. Go ahead, read it just by title only.
Yep. This is amending the bylaws of the Regional Planning and Coordinating Commission of Greene County, Ohio.
Why don't you read the whole thing since we haven't even read this yet?
Whereas the Village of Yellow Springs is a member of the Regional Planning and Coordinating Commission, RPCC, of Greene County, Ohio, and whereas the RPCC has proposed modification of financial provisions in Section 11 of its bylaws, and whereas Article 13.04 of the bylaws require any modification of financial provisions in Section 11 to be amended only after it has been confirmed by the County Commissioners of Greene County and a majority of the participating political subdivisions, such action to be completed within 6 months of the date of the proposed amendment by the County Commissioner's approval. Now, therefore, be it resolved by the Council of the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio, that, Section 1, the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio, confirms the proposed amendments to the RPCC bylaws, including the financial provision in Section 11. Section 2, this resolution shall go into effect at the earliest period allowed by law.
Can I have a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Okay, this was added. Patty, would you explain, or should
it was added at the last minute when I came back from my very relaxing vacation today. I found a packet from Greene County Regional Planning that these amendments were being proposed and that they needed this resolution back by the 22nd. And since we have one more meeting and that's a work session. It needed to go before council tonight. The primary provision that we're passing this resolution for is that they're changing the way that they charge communities. It's going to be a per capita, 25 cents per capita for villages of our size. Last year we paid, thank you, Melissa, $445.29 in January at the old rate. Under the new rate, which is 25 cents per person, it will be $871.75. So essentially this is doubling our fee, not quite doubling, but very close to doubling our fee to be a member of Greene County Regional Planning.
What was the formula they used before?
I have it right here. It said it was a sample formula of the county population times a number times seven to make a number of county units. It had to do
so
with the expected budget. It actually
it's
is
very complicated.
Yeah, it's
it
actually
was. This is simpler.
Yeah, okay. It's much simpler. It just
I'm just interested because they They had talked about actually reducing the rates for municipalities because they want municipalities to be involved. They want everybody to be involved because we're not direct beneficiaries of their services. It's more of a an associate kind of membership is how I would term it. So I'm a little disappointed. I'm a little surprised. Lori, is that was that discussed at the last meeting?
No. But I think my understanding is that it is likely to be less than what the big cities would pay, but it is a little bit more for us because our population is small.
Right, right. The county commissioners are going to pay 90 cents per capita.
Yeah, so their
townships are at 25 cents. And 10 cents per capita. For municipalities with a population of 20,000 or more, but for us, it is 25 cents per capita rate for municipalities with a population of less than 20,000.
So wait, we're paying the same rate that trustees or the townships are that are actually using their services?
Yes.
Wow.
And we're paying more than municipalities that are larger.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we are
paying
per head.
More per capita.
Per capita.
Yeah, that's what I mean.
Yeah.
I think we're getting the short end of this.
Yeah, I am very unhappy about this. Since you guys are going to have another meeting, I won't be here, but since you guys are going to have a special meeting, we want to table this and make some inquiries.
Because, you know, the way it stands right now, I would find it very difficult to vote yes on this. I mean,
we're talking pennies from their standpoint. Yeah. You know, we're talking a few hundred. It's us, Cedarville, Springdale. Okay. I mean, it's probably less than $1,000. Okay. And why would they do that us? I'd move that we table this.
Second.
And ask you to, are you okay with it since you're the rep?
Yeah, I'm totally fine.
And so this will come back to Lori, the September 21st special meeting.
Lori, are you going to call or do you want me to call?
Would be great calling.
So, but basically the action point here is advocating for the same rate as the larger municipalities, right?
Right. That's what I would say.
10
right.
cents per capita.
And I think I would hate to not be part of regional planning because I do think it is virtually one of the only places where we do have a voice in what's happening around us and that we do see where growth is going and what growth is happening. And from everything I see with Ken LeBlanc, they are getting more and what the county commissioners are going to be directing them, they will get into more planning than they are now, into more long-range planning. So I think it's actually a critical juncture for us to be involved, but I don't appreciate that, and I don't understand it. So,
and I would also suggest talking to some of the other smaller municipalities like Cedarville and just seeing.
I don't even know that any of them are members.
Oh, really? Okay.
Yeah. I think we may be the only small municipality.
No, the only ones who are not. You're right. Cedarville Village is not. Bowersville Village is not. I think we in Spring Valley, that Spring Valley is so small that theirs is rising from $61 to $119 because they only have 479 people.
So theirs is doubling
barely,
as well, though.
But it's still doubling, yeah.
Right.
Yeah, it is. But it's still pretty tiny, and I don't think they have much of a staff. So they're effectively like township.
Right, and effectively, if they're gaining $500 like from two small communities, I mean,
it's like, why are you doing that?
Right, right.
Yeah.
Okay, now we're at the time in the agenda where we hear from citizens about topics that are not on the agenda. And we ask that you come up to the podium, state your name, and keep your comments to 3 minutes, and Judy will be keeping track. Mr. Myers, your turn.
Hi, Henry Myers, 247 Whitehall. And I want to talk about the economic development portion of the thing. And Karen, I want to apologize, not apologize, but nothing personal. My topic here is basically what I was ranting about in the mid-80s when I had my shop and everything. But I do not think that the village should be supporting money-wise any of the downtown establishments, the retail establishments, or even the Chamber of Commerce. With the foot traffic that we have, I think that, quite honestly, if a establishment, including the Chamber, cannot make it, they need a different business plan. If the village is interested in doing something economically for small businesses, I would instead have you maybe look at the numerous self-employed contractors that we have throughout the village. They do what the village needs, what the people needs and everything. The village does not need a clock shop, for heaven's sakes. And so all these touristy type places are nice, and I like them as well as the next person, but not tax money, I don't believe. As far as the big businesses go, I can remember Kent Bristow occasionally saying that, you know, several businesses have inquired about you know, different sites that we had around and everything. Which seems to be, you know, something that they probably do, is, you know, businesses thinking of expanding and they let everybody know, what can you do for me? I've been asking a couple questions of when was the last time that we had a large business that was not homegrown and only got one response, and that was the original Antioch. It seems that homegrown businesses basically what we want. So I would say, you know, go more on you know, seeing what the village can do for the ones that seem to be going, to, you know, how can they help them expand in the village, maybe that type of thing. I would be a little bit cautious about putting money in them, though. I don't think we want to turn into a Chuck Colbert type fiasco. Thank you.
Thanks, Henry. No, excuse me, Mr. Myers. Anyone else? Talas?
Hello, my name is Tyler Sex. I just want to first off say, sometime last week on Tuesday or Wednesday, at the Emporium, the Black Lives Matter sign came down. I don't know what happened to it. Somebody ran by, snatched it off, and took off running. And I didn't even see that video with the police car cruiser that, with the incident with the Confederate flag. I didn't see it. I didn't need to see it because I was there. That officer was, he might not have sounded aggressive, but the way that he was acting towards me was very aggressive. And this isn't the first time. And if we can look up videos, we can see when, I think the officer's name is Knapp, when he told me that, once I find out you're not a valid driver, I'm putting you in jail. And that should be on that cruiser video also. That was only a year ago. Things like this should be documented, right? So that should be on there also. And then that same day when I had my work truck and they thought I wasn't a valid driver, when they told me to slow down on Corey Street and, you know, kind of harassed me in front of one of my clients on Corey Street, which I didn't think was cool. That's bad for my business. That's bad for my image. And any kind of attitude that I show towards a police officer is because I've been going through this since I was about 13, 14 years old. You know, it's pain that I got to sleep with every day. You know, for that officer to bypass two crowds of people and then come up to me first and say that I was involved in something and I had a little attitude because I was upset. Had a reason to be upset. I mean, this happens too much to me. And that's all I got to say.
Thanks, Talas.
Thank you, Talas.
Anyone else?
Okay, thank you. We have no special reports. The next item on the agenda is the ACE Task Force decision process. Mary Ann?
My suggestion for discussion is that we have a special meeting devoted to considering the benefits and the what's the opposite of benefits?
Pros and cons.
Pros.
Advantages and disadvantages?
The advantages and disadvantages of being in the ACE Task Force. And I see it more not so much like why we should, why we shouldn't, but really, what does it get us? What are the benefits of us being, what are the direct benefits of us being in that task force? And what are the things that we should be concerned about, the negative consequences, or the potential negative consequences for us being in the task force?
And costs.
Okay, including costs. Well, I guess the money could be on both sides. Mm-hmm. And that could be something to be considered. My thought was to have a couple people speak on the benefits, and my thought was our own chief and the head of the ACE Task Force, and have a couple people speak on their concerns about us being in the task force. Mm-hmm. One person that I have thought of and has indicated potentially a willingness is Ellis Jacobs to speak to that. There are a couple other people who could fill a second role for that. But I also thought it would be good to have someone who is a sort of a drug counselor kind of person, mm-hmm. who could just talk about what are the issues about people using drugs. We're not talking about illegal drugs. And what kind of facilities do we have currently that can have a positive impact? So sort of just looking at, so we can educate ourselves about what's happening in terms of illicit drug use, how it's being dealt with, other than the law enforcement part of it. So that was my thought.
Time frame?
Time frame? You mean as in what date?
When, yeah. I mean, I'm not a specific date, but, you know, like what time frame?
So I saw that it was suggested as being on October 5th.
And I will, we just put that in as a placeholder.
Right. Okay. Well, I mean, in my mind, and I think we kind of talked about this at the last meeting, it seems appropriate for a work session to have that initial discussion. And then subsequent to that, I would think that we would be ready to make a decision at a meeting after that.
We're probably going to have a special meeting,
right?
Because we've got the work session is the budget
booked up, mm-hmm. with the budget, mm-hmm.
and I guess, you know, I heard what Mary Ann said, but, you know, number one, we're asking for individuals, and you said probably the chief and head of the task force to talk about the pros or the benefits, mm-hmm. of belonging to the task force. But then you said we'd have someone talk about what might be potential negatives, and then also what is going on with drugs in general. Mm-hmm. And I think we're kind of mixing things, because, you know, The task force is not put together for trying to prevent the social use of drugs, or trying to solve the state or whatever has set up to handle drug issues. So I think it would be kind of unfair to have them speak to something that they have no control and maybe have some input in. But I think it should be, if we're going to be talking about the issue, it should be specifically as it, the pros and cons of the task force here in Yellow Springs. Now, the other things could be as a discussion, but to me, I think the issue that we're looking at is, should we or should we not belong to the task force? And those pros and cons should be based specifically on the benefits or non-benefits to Yellow Springs.
My thinking was really that there'd be five people, and two people basically pro, two people against, and one person that just talks about, this is the drug situation in Yellow Springs or Greene County. This is probably the amount of heroin that's being used. These are the facilities that exist. This is the treatment that's available. So we could be educated about the problem, because the task force exists to solve a problem, and it seems like it would be good to know what the problem is. That was my thinking.
And I agree with that. I just saying that, you know, as long as we're identifying it to what is going on in Yellow Springs, not what may be going on in other areas. But we also have to take into consideration what is going around that surrounds us, within the region. Well,
I also wonder if we should hear from somebody in Clark County, even though isn't in Clark County, it's Greene County, but I'm assuming we're being impacted by what's happening in Clark County.
Montgomery County too, so I'm not sure.
True. Okay, that's true.
Well,
probably Chief and Bruce May can.
My sense is that they can at least give a general picture about what's going on around us. And
Patty, you wanted to say something.
Well, the only other thing I wanted to point out is, first of all, I agree with Mary Ann, is that council does need to be educated on both sides. But remember that the task force does not only deal with drugs. They do deal with other issues as well. Vice, pedophilia, pornography, that type of thing. So there are more than just the drug issues. So if you are going to become educated, you have to keep in mind that it does encompass more than that. Probably is their largest problem that they deal with, but not the only one.
So maybe part of what they should talk about is, 80% of the time we're dealing with drugs and 5% of whatever.
Right, we spend this time here.
And particularly what is happening here.
Right.
Okay. So I guess the only debate I hear is whether a drug counselor type should be included in the mix, or we should just have Chief Bruce May, Ellis Jacobs, and one other person.
I mean, we want as much input as we can get, I think, so.
But I think to Patty's point and to Jerry's point, if we do single out a drug counselor, I'm afraid we'll lose track of the other work that the task force does. Or we'll de-emphasize it. So, I think we're going to have it's going to be hard. We've got four people, potentially five people, plus council to schedule for a meeting. So I think that what we need
to
do.
I would probably keep it as just the four. Just keep it focused, and then if we feel we need more information, we could invite somebody to do a follow up short presentation. Just because it's going to be
we'll have some citizen comment anyway. So I think.
Is there a time frame by which, as far as signing a contract with the task force, is it a first of the year thing?
If we choose to pull our body, that can be pulled at any point in time. If we do pay, it comes out of Steve's desk, that money, $10,500 around the first of the year. That is would be for 2016. Mm-hmm. That is, of course, seized asset money. It does not affect council's budget.
Okay. So we are potentially, it sounds like we don't have a hard deadline necessarily, but I would like, since this council has taken up this discussion, I would like this council to make the decision.
Right.
But
So we've got to come up with a date, it sounds like. Melissa, how much, I mean, I guess our, you know, is it, do we try to do it on the 5th? Do we try to do it on the 19th, or do we schedule a special meeting? And again, this will be discussion, not a decision, so we could do it during a work session. Mm-hmm. But it's looking like we're going to have a special meeting no matter what.
Well, and keep in mind that you already have one special meeting in November for the presentation of finals for the water plant. So, you know, my suggestion to council would be if you're going to have a special meeting, you probably should do it in September or October.
I think September would be too soon to
I think
schedule.
It's got to be October.
Mm-hmm. Is it? I'm sorry.
There's October 26th, I think.
That's a Monday, yes.
Do you have any wiggle room on your first reading of the budget that is generally not too involved with discussion?
Mm-hmm. But that's that? Still November. That would be
that's November 16th.
Right before another special meeting.
Yeah, that's but a little. It's a little late, I would mm-hmm. say.
Maybe I don't know.
Yeah, I agree. We should schedule it for October.
Mm-hmm. So would the 26th?
So
work?
The 26th would be the.
It's the fourth Monday.
That would give us enough time.
Because I think where we're saying we're probably going to have a planning commission meeting in October, because if we weren't, then we could. But I think we are going to need that.
Almost certainly.
Almost certainly.
Yeah.
Okay.
Percolating.
Yeah, yeah. So, yeah, let's. I think the 26th is basically our only option.
Yeah. Okay.
If you're going to do it on a Monday, you also have the 21st or 22nd, which is a Wednesday or Thursday.
Let's start with the 26th, yeah. And see if we can get everybody scheduled. And you'll pick a third or a second person, or I guess a fourth person, Mary Ann and Brian
yeah.
together.
Uh-huh.
Okay. And so,
Chief, does that work for your schedule? The 26th. Okay.
Then who will contact the head of the ACE?
Bruce.
I'll take care of that.
Okay, so October 26th.
Do you want to start at 6 or 7?
7.
7, okay. Okay.
Yeah.
Next, we're
And can we just say that's conditional? I want to make sure I'm at that meeting, and there may be a...
There may be what?
I may have a conflict.
Okay.
So,
I'm going to miss the next work session, too. And
okay.
I mean, when we're, unless somebody's willing to look at another date, if we want to set up two possible dates, now.
Okay.
Brian, is that something that you'll know in the next couple of days?
Yes.
I can just confirm with folks. And,
yes.
We can hold that second date. As a possibility,
okay.
Confirm as soon as Brian knows.
So you said either the 21st or the 22nd?
They're open on my calendar, and I have all the meetings on here, so.
Okay.
It's the 21st is a Wednesday, so that's
what
a Wednesday
month?
Or Thursday.
Yeah. Of October?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, okay.
Okay.
So we're looking at...
For me, the 22nd would be preferable. It's 21st is doable, but
yeah, I feel like the 22nd would work for sure.
So let's say October 22nd or the 26th.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
But I would prefer the 26th over the 22nd.
I would too. Okay. And Judy will be following up.
Yep.
Okay. And so, Marion, you're going to need to get Judy, or you're going to have to be checking on with these two folks that, okay.
Yeah, after we find out.
Okay. Policing vision statement, that's the next item on the agenda. We will, I will turn that over to Brian and or Marianne.
Okay. Well, I mean, I feel like from our last meeting, we felt good about this statement. One of the things that we had as an action item was to come up with a short statement. And I think, Karen, you had some thoughts that maybe we can share at this point about what that short statement might look like?
Well, one of the ideas I had, in my view, a vision statement should be a little more visionary than factual. And one of my ideas was the Village of Yellow Springs will have a police department that prioritizes public safety while ensuring that all are treated respectfully, mindful of our village values of being a welcoming community to all. And I actually had another one, but I don't know what that was.
Right. And I think that sounds great. And I agree with you that there's no reason to, you know, have a vision, the short statement repeating the, you know, the four, like, premises or principles. So I love tying it to our village goals. So I think that's a great idea.
So that would be instead of what's written not currently?
Yeah, in italics.
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm.
That sounds like a great idea.
There was one suggestion, actually Chrissy Cruz mentioned it, I'll bring up, that on the third bullet point, citizen focused, it pulls out the group Black Lives Matter. Now, Chrissy was saying, well, if this is a vision statement going on into the future, maybe we might want to use a more generic term than pulling out a particular group. So I'll just bring that up.
Yeah, and that makes sense because groups come and go.
So you're suggesting striking just such as Black Lives Matter?
Maybe just strike.
Yeah, just include, say as well as with identity groups.
And maybe we can polish that up a little bit more too. Because identity groups does seem a little bit vague to me. Because I think our goal would be, you know, at the next regular meeting to, with the resolution that Judy put together to, you know, pass this.
Well, if we're going to say youth, business owners, I can see why we want to matter. I think it's a good idea to mention black. Not necessarily Black Lives Matter, because that is kind of a current group, and we don't have a sense for how far in the future that phrase will be the organizing phrase, but somehow mentioning the specific issue or problem that, or the tension, maybe is a better word, that exists and historically has existed between African American people and the way that police forces have been operating.
Would you like to think of some way to say that?
I would probably want to talk to some folks before I made any attempt. I would talk to Talis and to Bomani, but I could certainly do so.
Great. Okay.
And I don't, you know. I think you should reach out to people of color within the community and get their input.
Okay.
And maybe it's a, right. I mean, there are so many organizations,
To single out two, I would be a slap in the face to the people of color within the community.
So maybe we can talk about who to contact.
I also, if there is a way to talk about groups that are having the, I don't know if I want to say the validity of the discussion. I mean, I would hate to all of a sudden have the Klan be an identity group that we're gonna. So somehow narrow it down to.
No, I mean it's groups of people that have been systemically abused, mistreated,
historically disenfranchised.
That's a lot different. That's honestly different than I thought, so I wasn't understanding it at all. So yeah, that needs to be worked on. That language needs to be worked on. So
okay,
cool. Okay, next on the agenda is the work session review. That can be really quick. what I just wanted to talk about. We said we would revisit it. We started doing it, I think, in after the retreat. We said we would revisit it. I just wanted to see how everybody was doing, one, how everybody thought they were going, how difficult it is to deal with the fact that we have to schedule special meetings frequently to make decisions, and also to consider the location. I know that something that Brian had talked about is, should we have them in a totally different location, potentially in A and B, as we did the discussion on policing, to set the tone that this isn't a formal council meeting, this is a work session where we're discussing. To me, if we did that, we would have to set that room up a little bit differently and make sure we had access to a screen, access to audio visual, and because often those meetings are presentation oriented.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yeah, I hate meeting in room A and B because it's just an awful empty room that is not thoughtfully arranged for anything that might need to go on, like a presentation. The acoustics are bad. It's not great for filming. I just don't like it. So I realize then it almost makes it pointless to try to have things that are called work sessions. That's how I feel.
I saw Susan nodding her head. Are you?
At first, I liked the idea, but once we did one in there, I agree with what Mary said. There's something about that room. I didn't think it was conducive to a good
give and take.
Right.
What if it were rearranged more like this? So instead of having council at one end, council was at one side, and so the people who were there were closer in a semicircle.
I think that part of it has to do with, though, part of the reason we did this table and we rearranged council chambers is to make life easier for our staff, that they didn't have to be spending a bunch of time setting up a room. And that's what they would end up doing, is spending a bunch of time setting up that room.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I don't really think it's a bunch of time. I mean, I can set up that room by myself in 10 minutes. You know, whether it's like the best setup, you know, I'm not sure. I mean, we do have the, you know, connection to fiber, so we can be broadcasting live. It was the first time. And we did get some feedback, you know, that was a good way to do that last meeting. So, I don't know.
Just to throw my two cents in, a work session is supposed to be a more relaxed atmosphere so that people feel a little more comfortable voicing opinions, honestly, which folks don't seem to have too much of an issue with here, but it is supposed to be a more relaxed atmosphere, and, you know, council's supposed to be more accessible, even if it's only the appearance of being more accessible. To me, AB and the way we set it up kind of encourages that a little bit more than, even if we're sitting up here and it's a little bit less formal, it still seems formal to me.
Yeah, but I didn't think the way it was set up last time. I thought with those long tables, I thought it was set up horribly. I thought it separated us more from the community. I feel like it's...
The original idea was for everybody to be around a table, but if you do that, it does virtually exclude the audience.
So. Right, yeah. I don't know what to say other than I hate meeting in A and B. I think I've made that clear. So I've never found that's a good room, a good space. It's got a bad vibe to me. But, you know.
Well,
that's just one person's opinion.
Why not try it again with our ACE task force discussion? I mean, get some other ideas about how to set it up, and, you know, revisited. I mean, I'm not ready myself just to say that's not going
to
work.
I'd like to hear from other people, Mary Ann and Jerry.
Well, I think I missed that meeting.
No, you were there.
You were there.
Yeah, I brought the swivel chair for you.
The policing discussion.
Oh, I'm sorry. I've got. I'd like to give it, you know, another try. I was comfortable with it. The audience appeared to be comfortable with it. But we've only had three work sessions.
Three or four, I think.
Three or four. So, you know, I'm kind of like Brian. I'm not ready to throw in the towel. You know, I think we just have to be a little bit more innovative or whatever and trying to see how we can come up with the best solution plus, you know, accommodate the filming and so forth.
And we need to be able to, go ahead, I'm sorry.
Well, the layout here is, I feel this is pretty intimate. You're kind of close. You're kind of right here. And that one, as Karen said, you were kind of over there and everybody else was kind of, it seemed tight over here. Kind of this U-shaped thing, you guys, and then kind of crammed everybody else. I don't know why it worked out that way. I think you're kind of intimate and you're kind of close and I can see all your faces, I can see all your expressions. You're right here.
And I don't know that there is a good wall. I mean, and Brian, so it's possible that then by the special meeting, by the ACE Task Force meeting, that one probably will not require a presentation. I doubt that there will be a PowerPoint or any other kind of a presentation with that. Mm-hmm. It is not an easy room to do PowerPoint presentations in. There isn't. It's very difficult, and we worked very hard on the layout of this to decide where these screens are going to go, where we're going to show, so that everybody can see it without having to turn around. And so that's the other issue that we have to deal with A and B, because the two policing meetings are the only special meetings that haven't had a PowerPoint presentation.
Mm-hmm. And it seems like there's kind of two issues. There's the issue of, do we like the structure of having work sessions, of having a business session like this, and then a work session. Mm-hmm. Does that seem to actually be helping? Does it seem to be solving a problem? So that's one question. And then the other question is, should work sessions be over in A and B? Should some work sessions be over in B? I guess I'm not 100% sure if the work session is solving problems without creating the other problem of having to call the special. I don't do the calling of a special meeting like we're going to have to again. So I'd like to hear from Judy. Like, does that make your life more difficult when we say, oh, yeah, once again, we can't have a strictly work session kind of thing because we also need to do some business, so we have to call a special meeting? Does that make much of a difference for you?
No, it's just a matter of letting people know what the case is. I think, though, what could be potentially a problem is when, and it, you know, it was brought up previously that you moved to 6 o'clock for
yes,
some of the,
that
and
confuses
there
people.
There was some blowback because folks thought they had missed things. So there is that difficulty, and believe me, it's so noticed everywhere. It's put out as much as one can put it out, but if you're in a town and the meeting's always at 7, you don't even look. I know if I go at 7, there's when the meeting will be, and that, I think, is the bigger issue, I would say.
So you're just saying not 6 o'clock?
I like not going till 11 o'clock at night. I like, yeah. I mean, it, it
well,
is a
I would say not
part.
6 o'clock if it's something that we can reasonably expect people are going to be coming specifically to comment on. The time we really screwed up was when we put it in the 6 o'clock meeting, and it was almost kind of announced separately, so that the people who were interested in the landlord issue and the utility issue thought they were going to come at 7 o'clock and have their piece, and had no idea that was what we were doing at 6 o'clock so we could do something else at 7 o'clock. That was when we screwed up, because we probably could have known that there were going to be people who wanted to speak to that.
Mm-hmm. So that said, I think if you're just sensitive to that issue and that sort of brought it front and center, I think everyone's awareness is engaged at this point. It's not an issue as far as notification goes, as long as that sensitivity remains to let's make sure that the hot topic is at 7, not at 6.
So that hasn't. So do we want to continue with work sessions? Since we've got 3 of them on the agenda, 2 of them on the agenda?
Yeah,
do they just become regular
I'm
with
happy.
Meetings?
Yeah, I mean, yeah, okay. I think we should.
So, mm-hmm. So we'll keep them
I
on
think
the.
It does help us to keep, like, this idea that we have one big topic and we're going to actually give it enough time. And mm-hmm. So we're going to try to not schedule a whole heck of a lot unless we really have no other choice but to do it. I think it does give us a little bit of discipline.
Right. Okay. And then, so then Brian and Patty will, and maybe Judy and Susan, mm-hmm. will work together to set up the meeting for the, or to set up A and B for the ACE Task Force meeting.
Which
day
is that?
Pardon?
It's either the 22nd or the 26th.
Of October.
I'll keep you in the loop.
And then the last thing on our old business agenda is the Charter Review Educational Statement. Is this something that, Patty, you will take care of, or will Chris discuss? Or is
Chris,
it just...
It's Chris's document, so...
Well...
So I just need to look over your shoulder. I did look at this stuff.
Council approved the charter amendments to go to the electorate. The village cannot endorse and say pass this or vote for this piece of legislation. However, the village may publish a educational piece to explain the rationale behind the initiative to make these charter amendments. So this was a kind of a summary of what we presented to council, what the Charter Review Committee put together. It was reviewed by Brian, and the initial draft, Brian on behalf of the committee, I think made some edits to it. And we feel that it summarizes succinctly as we can make it, although it's on 2 pages now, and hopefully maybe we can get it under 1.
It is on 1. It can be made to be on 1. We managed to make that happen when we sent it off to the folks for printing, so okay. It should just be a total of 6 pages.
So that's really all it is. So it's an educational piece, so the electorate can be more informed on what the rationale is.
I guess I thought there was going to be more explanation. Like, I thought the substantive changes might be, like, to say, you know, especially the ones that we're concerned about, which is the residency for the village manager, to say it's unlawful for us to, or something about, like, we can do it by contract, or it's against Ohio law. I'm afraid that we've made huge changes. I mean, there's huge sections in here that we've removed and put in totally new language, and I don't know that anybody's going to figure out why we're doing that.
Well,
from this
in the
document,
the report that was submitted to council, we have those explanations in there, so adding that would be difficult. It has to do with the length of the document, so I don't know what restraints there are on the pieces that tend to be mailed out.
I don't think there should be. I mean, I certainly to me shouldn't be length. I think people need to have the information. Brian, what do you think is the...
Yeah, I think that's a great suggestion. And, I mean...
And it's at the printer.
Oh.
Yeah, it's saying. I mean, we can. I mean, I can ask them to stop the presses and make a change.
Well,
I don't know
I mean,
how far it's gone. But
if it's... Is it one page?
Mm-hmm.
There can just be more printed. There can be more...
Yeah,
another page.
They've started printing it.
Well, they're folding it also. Print and fold, these stuff in labels.
What is it one sheet, 8.5 by 11, just 2-sided? Is that what's that?
No, it's 4, right?
It's 5 total. Because
okay.
This, we wanted to show, this is what you're looking at. When you go to vote, this is what you're going to see taped to the side, or stuck to the side of every booth, and that's what you're voting on. And then this was the supposed to be a very concise explanation of this confusing document, this is what we're doing in it. It goes again in the paper. This will all get repeated in the paper, and that might be an excellent time to flesh it out a little further.
So the colors indicate what kind of changes?
Is it going to be in color?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Oh, well, why isn't it in red and blue?
It's blue and it's purple.
But even here, why?
Right.
Why not? Why isn't it in red and blue on the explanation?
We don't know what's substantive or what's conformance or what's typographical. As somebody's looking at this, they're not going to know what the red means, what the blue means, and what the purple means.
Well, I don't think that there was an intention that the color coordination meant anything by way of what the change was. It's simply, I don't know why it comes up with a different color. Specifically, when you do the strike through, that would show one color, and then the additional language would be
not working that way, though.
But so are you telling me that this
is that random?
That there's going to be all three different colors in what you're having printed?
Yeah. I'm not seeing black, blue, and red.
There's black, a purplish.
There's some kind of purplish at times.
I think it's mostly capitalization issues and things like that.
Look at this document.
Look at section 18.
Judy. Section 14 is blue. Section 18 is blue. Section 30 is blue.
Yeah, section 18 has purple and blue.
It's kind of a mess.
It feels kind of random. The color.
Well, we're only paying for three colors, so I'm gonna think it's not gonna be all these colors.
Why are we paying for red and blue, though? What is the difference between the red and what is the difference between the blue?
And is that what they're gonna see on the ballot?
Yeah. I mean, that's what I got sent back from the Board of Elections. That is what I got.
Oh wait, so the Board of Elections made the colors?
Mm-hmm. Unless my computer did something weird, which I'm not going to take any kind of...
So did we run it by the Board of Elections before we...
Yeah, I mean, this came from... This is...
This is their document.
This is
So
I can tell you on my iPad, and I simply downloaded a packet that was sent out on Friday. All the changes on my iPad show up.
Well, I think that was too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mine's actually showing like four different colors.
Well, I will call the guy who's doing the printing and say, I sent you this, I want you to look at it and tell me exactly what you're looking at and how it's gonna print out.
Well, my other thought is, so if it hasn't been printed yet, I can imagine on the back page of the cover sheet highlights about, I think what Karen was referring to as the substantive. So we could write a little bit more about that.
Well, if you're dead certain, just given that this is the way the Board of Elections did it, I don't want to go into an interpretation.
That is incorrect.
Yeah. I'll call the Board of Elections and I'll call the fellow who's doing the printing.
But they didn't. Did the Board of Elections give you this explanation for proposed 2015 charter amendments?
No, that's coming from Chris Conard.
Okay.
The Board of Elections determined that this is just too darn confusing to put on a ballot, and it's far, far, far too long. So their solution was, we will take this document, which they then sent back to me, and we're going to attach it to the side of every ballot box. And this is what the ballot's going to look like.
And also on the DGISB front page.
That one page, correct?
That's it. Yep. Mm-hmm. That's it.
Right there.
And so what we're saying here is, people, this is all you're going to get to see when you vote. Right. This is what you're going to be looking at on the side of the ballot box to explain it. And this is how we're trying to explain.
And so these extra pages, I mean, mine's got blank pages.
Yeah. I think that had to do with the formatting
right.
of mm-hmm. Judy's computer.
Yeah, that's a different.
But who's going to print the Board of Elections will print what's on the ballot box.
Yes.
For the.
But are you printing this whole document and sending it to all people in Yellow Springs?
Yes, except I.
With all those extra spaces?
No.
No?
I said reformat. This is a total of 4 pages front and back. This is one page. So you're getting a 5-page document.
Okay.
Folded.
Can I see your 4-page, please?
Four pages or 5 pages?
It's all because of the PDF.
Yeah.
So, and this document you wrote, Brian, the explanation? Did you write, or?
Mostly Chris did.
Chris did?
Yes. So I reviewed it.
Is there going to be any other education being done? I mean, I know you said there'll be another chance to.
It has to go in the.
Into the Yellow Springs News.
Yeah. And that, we sort of shot for end of October for that one because it's just prior to the election. The hope is that it will still be fresh in people's minds, that it can kind of follow up along this. And the hope was that people will say, oh, yeah, that's that mailing I got. And it maybe gives a little more information.
But it's that's the total of the campaign. It's just.
There cannot be a campaign.
No, well, we cannot do a campaign.
As a body.
As a body. But like when we do, same thing true for a levy, we cannot do a campaign. We can only educate. But
if
citizens.
If a council member wants to write a letter of explanation to the news, if it were published, you certainly can do that.
Right. If the charter committee, review committee wanted to write a letter to the news or wanted to make any kind of public statement saying this is what we did and we endorse this kind of thing, I mean, they can endorse. We cannot.
They cannot.
I would say that avoid the word endorsement.
Okay.
Explain what the rationale was and the idea being that the informed electorate would make their own, the individual would make his or her own decision.
And Judy, I'm sorry to be bringing up all these things, but in this, what's on the ballot, it says shall sections, there's a bunch of numbers and it ends
and
with a comma.
It
seems like that information isn't complete. It seems like the ballot language is actually not complete.
The first page.
It ends.
It flows over onto page 2 online.
Right.
Okay.
But then that's
but
not.
But if it wasn't formatted that way.
Then it's going to look different.
No, I think what I saw, everything will be on the one page of the ballot.
Yeah.
All that language is not going to be flipped open. That's all going to. That's all will be there.
I agree. What got sent to the printer?
Yeah. In addition to that.
Yeah.
Then there will be that larger thing that a person can read if they so desire.
Right.
I understand that. What got sent?
This is what we're trying to do.
Right. And I.
That we got to get the format.
And what we're looking at, probably it may not have gotten formatted and printed correctly for what the citizens are receiving.
Judy, on the 5-page, when they got it this down to 5 pages, mm-hmm. Is it correct?
I haven't gotten approved.
Okay.
So, I mean, I will certainly get approved before anything happens. So.
Right.
Okay. So likely then he also has not printed this one pager off.
Better not if he wants to get paid. I mean, I need to see a proof.
Yeah. Okay. So we've got time.
So we could
make some changes. Yes. So then there could be a back page since we've got, you know, essentially, you know, a front and back that could highlight, I guess, the substantive things if we wanted to educate more on that.
Are these going into an envelope, Judy?
Yeah.
Okay.
And we've got the language drafted. I mean, it would simply be better if tinkering. Mm-hmm.
And I think we could just
to fit with the size restraints, maybe if there are any.
And we could just talk about rationales for the substantive changes and highlight those sections.
Yeah.
So,
I agree with Karen. I'm willing to go on to a second page with more details.
Right. And it basically means 3 pages front and back. And right now, we've got three pages, one of them single-sided. So it's not going to change the number of pages. Does that make sense?
Not going to, no, number
of sheets. Well, it's
going to. Number of sheets, right.
Right, I mean, it'll increase our printing charges.
But not by much. I think it's worth it to do it.
I think it's got to be right, and it's got to have the information.
And I would say the proposed changes are reflected with additions underlined. Go ahead and underline that word. So, and then deletions marked by strike through, the way you've marked the strike through in the letter. I would say that.
And I guess also verify this color issue.
I think we should. If we're paying for three colors, but we only really need two, what the heck?
I mean, maybe you might need to call the Board of Elections, Judy, and find out if the colors, from their standpoint, had any meaning.
For me, if there's no logic, like why something is blue and why something is red.
Or purple.
It could all just be one color.
It just confuses me, like.
No, but I thought when we put it together, the blue was the change, the red was the strikeout.
No, that is not, that's not the way it's.
Well, and then when I look back on some of mine, there was purple when I was looking at it, but not in other places.
I think the purple is an off shade of the blue. It just didn't come through, because if you look at the red, there's a darker red in some places as well.
So I would like to better understand, if the Board of Election needs it to be in red and blue, fine. But is there a logic to the parts that are red and the parts that are blue? I can't find any header. I can't understand.
Okay, so the action steps here are, I need to verify first with the Board of Election regarding color and what their formatting looks like. Then go back to the printer and, depending on the information from the Board of Election, either say, we only need two colors here, and get a new proof or proof that's based on that. And Brian, you want to tinker with this first page, and so we'll just tell them hold the presses on the first page. We're going to give you a new
Draft. And we'll, you know, limit it to a backside that's got highlights on the substantive changes.
I would just hold all the printing, because they're going to print it all at once. It's a document. They're going to collate it. They're not going to print one page and not the other. I would just hold the printing until you're absolutely confident of everything. Mm-hmm. That's the first thing I would do.
Yeah, because it's all folded.
And I would say maybe both Brian and Karen should do one more look over, just to make sure, because it's going to be expensive, and we don't want miseducation that could throw off the election. Am I right?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. All right. We'll have the revised version to you in the morning.
Cool.
Thanks.
Thank you.
And I'll communicate with everybody on that, just sort of what the information is, so you're not hanging till the next meeting for that information.
Great. Thank you.
Next is, we're on to new business, public art policy review. That is for Brian.
Yeah. So I didn't see it in the electronic packet, but we did have it in the last meeting. And I think we all read it. The highlights here are that this revised version of the public art policy has streamlined what's there, has made it more user-friendly, so that artists that want to apply for projects can actually understand it, because that was a big complaint. And the last thing is that it removed editorial comments that I don't think ever needed to be there. So I think that it's still the same document in substance. I would love for us to make a decision and move forward, because I already know there are artists that, you know, would like to propose to our commission to hang art again on the second floor. And it's no substantive changes, just clarity and user friendliness.
I'm trying to pull it up on.
Oh, from last time.
No, my computer died, so I want to pull the. I just realized I could probably pull it up on my phone.
But you'll have to go to the last meeting, because it's not in this electronic packet.
So, I think here.
Oh, thank you.
And this was vetted for a couple months by the Public Art Commission. Their recommendation is that we go with this streamlined version.
Yeah, I think it's good.
It looks fine.
I think it's.
Yep.
Do you think, are you looking for, well, I mean, if we want, if we're looking for a resolution, then do you think it needs to be passed by resolution, or can it just be passed by a motion?
It's a policy change.
You think it needs a resolution?
I don't know that it needs a resolution. Resolutions just make it a lot easier to find and identify and placehold, so it's not a bad idea if you're not in a rush to attach it to a resolution. It just makes it very easy for somebody 15 years from now.
And I think that's fine.
Can we say, can we have a formal resolution, but say it's certainly fine for me to
if you want to start discussing,
giving this out, and people can start looking, using. I think we can pass it tonight and then just have a formal resolution
at the next meeting.
Formally passes
it. You can accept the policies. Just accept the policy for dissemination.
Okay.
So can we have a motion to accept the policy on village, on the use of village property for various types of art?
So moved.
Do we have a second?
I'll second.
Okay. So at the next meeting, there will be a formal resolution, so future clerks can find the information.
You want a consensus or a motion?
Yeah, no, so we have a vote. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
No, I thought we might have a little bit more discussion, but no, we voted, so.
Well, okay, I should have asked if there's more discussion. I'm sorry. I guess you guys can discuss it at the next meeting when you're voting on the resolution. Village manager evaluation process. Lori and Brian, I think, worked on this and provided us with a schedule. September 21st to October 21st, citizen input and direct reports feedback period. I think my biggest question about that is the confidentiality aspect, and how are these things going to be kept confidential if they're being sent by email to our clerk?
What?
Citizen input and direct report, and direct reports. I mean, I know when we did it before, we had, it was a written form, and they had to put it in an envelope. They gave a sealed envelope to Judy.
Right, for that's a good point. I didn't think about that. I think certainly for direct reports, that's appropriate. Mm-hmm. Citizens, nothing can be confidential from citizens. I don't think it becomes a public document, and they're not required to use the format.
Right. Okay. So let's say then.
I don't think so, Chris. Am I? It just seems to me that it's kind of different getting direct information from citizens.
In what sense? Is it being public, you mean?
Yeah. Is there a problem with citizens emailing? And the confidentiality is to protect people who, from any retaliation. That's what I would assume.
Well,
or is it?
I think that if someone were to make a records request to review information that was sent in a public site, I think it would be a public record.
Right.
I don't think there's any way around that. I think that in the past, consistent with practices the village has had, that fact has not been a deterrent from people's willingness to comment and participate in the review, and I think we just have to rely upon that past practice and the good judgment of people and respecting the process.
So are we saying we won't accept if we have a personal conversation or something personal with a citizen, we can relay that? I mean, if there are citizens, I'm assuming, may choose, sorry, Patty, but if they have something less than favorable to say, and they know it's going to be public, it's likely they're not going to send an email if they know it's going to be public.
Right. They can,
so we're going
to. They can call and talk to us. They can grab us in Tom's. They can tell us.
And we can certainly highlight that as well.
I think
we always do, which is, you know, any sort of, you know,
so we
communication.
So we need to change out that the supervisors, the direct reports, that's going to have to be they're going to either have to use, if they use an online form or a written form, it's going to have to be put in an envelope and given to the clerk.
Oh, that's
fine. Sealed envelope.
And I distributed those last time with envelopes and said, seal it and put it in my box.
We'll just rewrite that to make that clear, that that's what the process will be, that it'll be in a sealed envelope.
Right.
And then citizen comments, citizens can come in any form.
Right.
But I think it's nice for us to have a form that citizens can use if they want to do it that way.
I agree. I think that's fine. I think that we should let them know, though, that if they send a form or if they send it via email to the clerk, or that that anything but a private conversation is up for public records request.
Yes. Okay.
Or is available to the public. So October 28th, we will get our forms done. So you'll provide those forms for us. And
yes.
We'll get that done. November 2nd is executive session to discuss the evaluation, where we'll actually do the evaluation ourselves. And Patty will come to that meeting. So we will be in executive session alone, and then we will ask Patty to come in. And then December 7th, the evaluation will be reviewed at a public meeting. I think that's...
Yeah.
Is that the... It's November 2nd, or do we want that... Do we have a time frame in mind? Do we want that to be before our meeting or after?
Yeah. Yes, I think so. Mm-hmm. So do we think we can get it all done? So having us... In an hour, unless, I guess we could start whenever we want. We could start at 5 or 5:30.
Right.
Yeah, I don't have any meetings or anything that day, so.
Right.
So let's leave that open. Let's say maybe 5:30 or something on November 2nd.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And then ultimately, just to highlight that the goal here is to have a process that we can duplicate annually.
Oh, that's great,
obviously,
yeah.
The dates will change a little bit based on our meetings, but...
I think this is great. Yeah, good. Okay. Looks good. Jerry, comment? Looks good to you?
No, it's fine to me.
Okay, cool. And then last, Mary Ann, could an issue that you brought about drones in the village?
Yeah, I had a citizen come up to me in Tom's. saying that she had seen a drone flying over the high school, I think. Mm-hmm. And she wanted to know whether we had any rules or legislation, or could have any, about that.
Does she know what it was
for? No.
Okay.
I believe that we have some local youth who have a... It's a radio controlled kind of thing. I don't know that it's necessarily would be classified as a drone, but it probably looks like a drone. And I know that at one point they were flying it on the Antioch campus and got it stuck on a roof. Correct, Chief?
It wasn't actually stuck on the roof. They thought it may have been.
So, and it's just a couple of our local youth who fly this thing around. So. I mean, it would be my guess that it was probably them or someone else who has a personal drone or radio-controlled airplane type of thing.
I think this is a bigger discussion, though, because there's a lot of uses for drones that are absolutely lawful, and I don't think we should be... I would want to hear from our attorney, and... I don't know that I feel like do we want to add this to the agenda now, or do we want to have...
I can address some of it.
When I last visited this subject, it was a little less than a year ago, the FAA had reserved all rights to control all aspects of drone use, which means anybody who was to fly a drone had to have FAA permission. Obviously, there's quite a bit of tension with that because there's so many applications that drones can be used for that make a lot of sense, particularly in an area like this, because they're very helpful in mapping farms and seeing what's going on. There has been an easing of that, and I believe that the FAA now has relinquished given up some of that power. I can't tell you what has been done exactly yet, because I don't think that the rulemaking's been done. And in fact, in today's mail, I just received a flyer for continuing legal education on the issue of drones and the law and what does that mean. So it's really an evolving area of law, and I can't give you a definitive answer without looking into it. And even if I did give you one today, I couldn't tell you that in 6 months from now that would be where we are on the subject. But I do think that it's something that we should talk about, because it's another one of those emerging things, and it may be something that that communities want to regulate in some way so that we know where we stand, because they have the potential to be an invasive technology that we want some rules on.
Can I ask, I'll ask a real quick question. If somebody feels that somebody is using a personal drone to spy on or to unlawfully look into somebody's house or backyard or whatever, does Chief have the power to do something about that?
Well, certainly it would have the power to suggest that it's not a practice that one should continue, and strongly urge someone not to do it. If you're asking whether or not he would have the power to cite someone for that, I'd have to look at our ordinances and state law. I couldn't tell you right now. It's the way it was 20 years ago when we knew what telephone harassment was, before there was telecommunications harassment. The law is slow to react to these situations, and I don't know what the state of the law is right now.
So obviously we're not going to solve anything, but it's a big subject that I guess put on your...
Well, we should probably put that at the same time when we have to talk about what happens if marijuana is legalized.
Thanks, Chris. We have manager and assistant village manager reports. Maybe we just have do you have a report,
Patty? I have two quick things, because I was on vacation, so I don't have an official report. I did want to clarify one thing that perhaps I didn't explain well or didn't make clear at the last meeting. When I was talking about some of the duties that Melissa would be taking over, eventually Melissa will be moving into planning and zoning, but that will not be the case right now. For right now, Denise Swinger, who is the new planning and zoning and economic development liaison, reports to me. Melissa has other things that she's got to get a feel for. She's dealing with the Safe Routes to School projects and things like that. So there seemed to be a little confusion as to who Denise was reporting to. And I may have added to that by saying eventually she will report to Melissa. But for now, Denise reports to me. She's a direct report to me in my office and does not report to Melissa. So I just wanted to make that clear. And the only other thing that I have is that I would like to mention that Councilperson Sims has a birthday coming up on Saturday, and I wanted to wish him a happy birthday.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, I'm sure you.
All right, that's all I have.
Melissa?
I just had one quick thing just to piggyback on the Wayne Cannon presentation for the utility rate studies. He's going to be presenting some rate increase suggestions, so I'd like for council to have some discussion on that so that I can have some direction for the budget.
Great. And I would like to thank Melissa for handling everything so well while I was gone. I did not get one phone call the entire week while I was relaxing, floating around on the lake on my little float pad with my kayak paddle. So thank you, Melissa.
And training for the walk.
I was training for the walk, yes, still. But.
Clerk's report?
Yeah, I was just going to give a little feedback on the Planning Commission meeting, just to say that Denise was present for that meeting. She's been following right along. She's going to flow right into the next meeting where text amendments will be discussed, and so she's been educated on that process, and we're just sort of continuing to move forward. That seemed like a relatively smooth baton handoff. Then just to say that I'm on the board for the Ohio Municipal Clerks Association at this point, part of which means we're going to get a hopefully large number of clerks wandering about town on November 20th for a training day in town. New Assistant Clerk Hope Collins is doing an excellent job learning quickly, helping me with computer-related insanity. And then to give folks a heads up that this mailing will be coming out once we get it repaired.
Okay, thank you. Future agenda items. So September 21st, we already have our work session with Wayne Cannon from RCAP on the utility rate study. That's already scheduled for 6 p.m. So scheduling the special meeting is going to be a little bit tricky. I am not going to be at that meeting, so I don't know if Lori can sit in on the next agenda planning meeting. That would be helpful.
Which meeting aren't you going to be at?
I'm not going to be at the September 21st
meeting. The work session.
And I may not be.
Oh. So then we may have an issue with this legislation, two pieces of legislation. Mary Ann, that's where we just decided we were going to do the vote on your legislation.
Well, what I thought is I might just be, I'm having minor surgery. So I thought I might just come in for that.
Oh, for that part of it? I mean, it's really, the issues are what are the legislation? Is it just the grant, or was there one more?
It's the grant, and it's the RPCC, RR.
Oh, right, RPCC.
Yeah.
Right, and potentially the public arts resolution.
I think we should pull, that one. I'm sorry, Brian, but.
Yeah, I mean, does it have to go?
No. I mean, I think we've got consensus that the format makes sense, so whenever we formally adopt that, it doesn't really matter at this point.
Right, and we'll just want to hear, let Jerry have his,
sure,
and express his concerns.
Right.
We can always rescind, if Jerry makes a compelling case for not going forward, mm-hmm, or has concerns.
Do we have any idea how long Wayne Cannon's going to be?
Oh, I'd give him at least 2.5 hours.
Are you serious?
Uh-huh.
Mm-hmm. I mean, it's up to you guys, but I don't see that special meeting happen.
Wayne's presentation will take at least an hour, and then you're going to have quite a few questions, I think, on top of that. Mm-hmm. So I would allow 2.5 hours if you get done early.
I mean, can you go?
I don't have enough.
6:30.
Yeah, I mean, if you have the special meeting at 6 o'clock. You're passing two resolutions, and I don't think either one of them will have a horrible amount of discussion. And just once you adjourn the special meeting, begin Wayne's at 6:30.
So you're suggesting, okay.
Just start at 6 with the special meeting and move Wayne's presentation to 6:30.
I think that depending upon what's found out, I think that about the grant and about the...
We could start at 5:30. That would give us an hour.
That is strange.
Well, I guess the concern that I might have on that is that you do have some folks who are invested in that resolution regarding the grant, and if, mm-hmm, you move to 5:30, the likelihood that they're home from work, able to attend, et cetera, you start running into that issue.
Okay. Well, let's do it at 6 and just hope for the best.
Yeah, I mean,
so you're okay with, I mean, we scheduled that at 6 p.m. because Wayne Cannon has a long drive.
We'll move him to 6:30. He'll be all right with it.
Okay.
And I guess I did check, so related to the October 22nd, 26th, if I'm going to be present, it's got to be on October 22nd.
That's the task force?
Yes.
Okay, 7 o'clock on the 22nd.
So, I mean, but that still all has to be confirmed with all of the
right,
all of the participants.
So we can make that the primary time, and then the 26th becomes the backup time.
Yeah, I think that makes sense.
Okay. Only if, you know, we can't make it work otherwise.
Right. Okay. So we'll change that date to October 22nd. Mm-hmm. We'll change the order.
Right.
Let's see. Will the legislation, so then moving on to October 5th, general fund budget, that will be Melissa. That will take up a lot of the meeting. Will the ordinances, approval of ordinances standardizing language for certain boards and commissions, will that be ready?
Yep.
For consent agenda? Okay. and then anything else that comes up at that meeting. Then October 19th will be a work session about budgets, about special revenue, enterprise special revenue fund and capital budgets. And then we'll try to finish up the budget, complete budget on November 2nd. We saved, then we'll do the work session, the 2016 budget as a first reading at the work session. We don't need, because we're not making the final decision, we can do it at a work session.
Correct.
And then if we need, we're leaving ourselves an extra work session if we need it, if there are any questions. And then maybe we want, with December 21st.
When do you normally do your agenda planning?
Well, it's been kind of floating around, usually on a Friday, but I'm sure that they can.
No, Friday's usually okay for me if I know in advance.
Friday at 9, Lori.
And then I guess one other thing just to plan for is the follow-up on the ACE task force after we have the work session.
So that would be,
I guess the first
that would be November 2nd. That would be November 2nd.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Okay. Then we're kind of, the levy resolutions, we know they need to be done by December 21st. We may be able to get to those a little bit earlier, get those on the December 7th agenda. And then there's something, this House Bill 5 thing is something that Chris is working on. So,
and then the resolution for policing, the policing vision is October 5th?
Yeah. You'll be ready for that? Okay.
Well, we've just got the new short statement.
Tweaking.
Some tweaking.
Okay. I think we're good. So, a motion to adjourn.
Second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Thank you all.
Yeah, thank you. Mm-hmm.